Bob, oh, that's all right. You're there because Bob usually has done it. I got you. And Danielle,
I'm
I know.
In the hot seat.
Danielle is excused.
Tim Jones is not here. And
I know that. He called me.
Brian Lapham.
Yes. Brian, yeah. Poor Brian is
Who's
not.
Who's Brian?
Well, he's sick.
Yeah, he is not.
Does he?
He's got cancer.
He's had a terrible year.
Oh, yeah. He looks bad.
Yeah.
He's had an awful year.
Danielle.
I was going to ask you that. Brian. I forgot.
Oh, you're wonderful.
Hey, Brian.
I was like, what did you do?
Kathleen, the 20th.
Jones and Danielle.
And one extra.
Jones and Danielle, and we have an extra.
Okay.
Are you contagious?
No. There we go. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This work session for the Hampton Municipal Budget Committee on the SAU United School District Budget is called to order at 7:04 p.m. on December 8, 2016. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Why doesn't my seat move?
Oh, you got something under it.
Oh,
your pocketbook?
Yeah.
Oh, wait, you didn't have this
thing in
the book of all the hospital.
Okay, there we go.
Thank you, Dad. Oh, that's better.
Starting on the viewer's right. Starting on the viewer's right, will the members of the committee please introduce themselves to the public?
Jimmy Bridle, Hampton School Board Rep.
Regina Barnes, Board of Selectmen Rep.
Mike Pierce.
Sonny Kravitz.
Brian Lapham.
Steve Henderson.
Mike Pope. Stephen LeBranch.
Maureen Buckley, representing the Hampton Beach Village District.
David Maurer.
And our secretary is Barbara Kravitz. Mr. Jones has been excused. He is not feeling well. And Danielle Augustine had another commitment and is not able to make. So they are both to be marked as excused, please, Barbara, in the minutes. Okay, welcoming Superintendent Kathleen Murphy and Finance Administrator Nathan Lunny, and Principal of the Academy, Mr. O'Connor, is in the audience. Mrs. Costa, Principal of Marston, is in the audience. Mr. Lannon, the Principal at Center School, is in the audience. And our, the Vice Chairman of the School Board, Mrs. Shepherd, is there. Am I missing anybody else? And Pepper Ring from the School Board. I think that's our full house. We're going to start with the operating budget and then proceed to the money articles. And the last thing we will address is the renovation article. So if you will turn.
Madam Chairman.
Yes, ma'am.
I would like to move $20,635,850, which is the school budget.
I'll second.
Okay. Moved by Mrs. Bridle Russell, seconded by Mr. Henderson. All right, let's go into our budget pages. And I really appreciate, Mr. Lunny, the summary introduction that you included inside the front cover for the proposed fiscal year 2017-2018 operating budget. It's very explicit on the drivers of the default budget increase and the drivers of the decrease. And you have been very specific on the school default budget. And we are very grateful. Now, I'm going to turn it over to you and talk to us.
May I start by offering introduction of the staff that have joined us? Our administrative team is here.
Oh, good.
The superintendent and myself. You've mentioned the principal of Hampton Academy, Mr. O'Connor. Lois Costa, principal of Marston School, is with us. Behind them, her assistant principal, Nathan Sadler, on your right. Our director of pupil services, Jessica Parsons, is with us. Mary Borg is our food service director. And in the back row behind them, you have Anna DeWilder, who is the new assistant principal at Hampton Academy, and Tim Lannan, principal at Center School.
And the wonderful
For those of you that have not had the pleasure of making his acquaintance, our returning eighth grader, facilities director, Keith Lassard.
And Mary Borg.
And Mary Borg, yes. I did get married, yep. I would...
The gang is all here.
We took that minute because they are very much a part of the team. They are instrumental in developing this. This wouldn't happen, the work that's done, without their work, without their expertise and their support. And they wanted to be here tonight. And so thanks for letting us do that, because they are great to work with. Great team.
The secret is that I so like an audience, and they have to defer and let me talk, because I don't get to talk nearly enough during the course of the regular season. And
we will let you talk as long as you want to.
In your hands tonight, there are a couple of documents. One that we certainly want to speak to, another that we may need as a reference. The first actually says fiscal year 17-18 warrant. The slides are included in there. There are some additional documents that we'll refer to as we march through the presentation tonight. Traditionally, we come to you in December with the operating budget. We come to you in January, the first week or so, with the money articles, the warrant articles. The chair had asked us if we couldn't wrap it all up tonight for you, given the demanding schedule that you have. And so we structured the presentation more like January, in that the warrant is included. The board has had a chance to consider the warrant. They formally voted on two articles, and the other two, I think, are a formality that they'll deal with Tuesday night at their meeting, I hope. But we'll start with operating budget, which is article number two, and then we'll work our way through articles three and four, and then we'll come back to article one, which will be the Hampton Academy Reconstruction Project, if that works. And so the first packet walks us through that. The second one is more a resource. If there are questions when we get to talking about the Hampton Academy project, but also for all of you as folks who will consider that on the warrant, it's a resource for you to take and use as you see fit. So, having said that, I know the superintendent has some opening comments that she wants to make, so let me defer.
I want to get right into it, but yes. The first page talks about the mission statement, and that's really important. I start this off every year with that mission statement, because that's what drives the work that we do every year. And I just want to highlight a couple things in that mission statement. I'm not going to read it, but I want you to focus on some phrases in there. Encouraging educational environment. That's very important, and you'll see the budget is built with that in mind, that we have an environment that encourages learning. The second thing is that we recognize learning experiences as meaningful. Well, you know, what does that really mean? But what it means is we're using technology. We're using 21st century skills with the kids so that we're enhancing their learning. And it's meaningful to them. You'll see more and more in the budget where kids are doing hands-on and they're learning in different ways. Sometimes they're learning online. Sometimes they're learning, in many cases, the textbooks are gone and they're using the resources that are online. So the budget is built with that in mind. Core fundamentals, core subjects is very important. When I talk about core math, reading, social studies, and science. But we can't forget those other areas, those integrated arts that are so important. And the support staff that we have that help us with all the youngsters that have specialized learning plans. And last but not least, thinking, problem solving, critical thinking, and communication. That's all around some of the things we're doing now with STEM education. We now just opened up an innovation lab at Marston, where the kids are using Lego robots and building and developing and analyzing and planning projects. And last, the communication. We were fortunate, as you know, to receive money from the franchise fees. That money has been used for us for the Shark News and the Channel 13. And that's part of this mission, because communication is important. All you have to do is go to the Hampton Academy website, click on Shark News, and see these youngsters, these middle school kids, who are very poised, who are very articulate, and it's because they've had an opportunity to have funds that have enabled them to use that way of communicating. educating. So I have to highlight that because I think the mission statement for the district is what drives all of us. And of course, the next most important thing are the six goals that have been developed. These are the new goals. The board goes through a process every year of looking at what's happening in the district, what are the needs, where do they want to focus, and every year they revisit these, and sometimes they stay the same, sometimes they change up. But the first one is all around curriculum and assessment and instruction. You'll see that in the budget. Human capital, those are our teachers. Those are positions that we need in order to be successful with the youngsters. Communication, I alluded to the shock news, but we're using Channel 13 and our websites, and we now are tweeting, and we have a Facebook account. So all of those ways for us to communicate are really important, and that's why the board has, for the 6 years we've been here, has always had that as a goal, because we wanted to reach out to the community and our stakeholders. Governance is always on there also, because the board has an obligation to review policies and to address issues in the community. What kind of issues might they do? Things like contracts, grants, starting time. They've done an analysis about when start times for when the kids come into school. So those are the kinds of big issues. And we have funds in there so that we can do some research and design when those things come up. Finance and facility, of course, we'll talk about that tonight. Incredible, we need the money to be able to do the work that we do. And probably I would say their number one priority this year has been the successful passage of a warrant article for Hampton Academy. And I think you'll see that played in our presentation when we do on the warrant. So I don't want to, unless there's any questions, I want to go right to Nathan, because he's going to jump in and he's going to start the questions on the operational budget.
So everyone received the budget book. We had a chance to look through that function by function, line by line, if you like. Certainly I'm willing, as a part of this tonight, this conversation tonight, to talk about any particular line you might have. But one, because as I've said before, Dad always told me, tell them what you're going to tell them, then tell them, then tell them what you told them. And because I've learned in my time working in the schools that different learning styles mean that different approaches or call for different approaches. And so I try to wrap this conversation of these budget numbers up in as many different ways as I can, as quickly as I can. I'm also guilty of talking quickly because of that, because I want to get through a whole lot of information. Slow me down, throw the flag if there's a question or something that doesn't make sense. But let me take you through. Article 2 will be the operating budget. That language is according to statute. The budget as proposed, Ms. Bridle already referenced $20,635,850. Start at the beginning, which is where are we today? At your March 16 meeting for the fiscal year that started July 1st of 16 and will end next June 30th, our operating budget is $20,423,340. You passed the long-term maintenance article of $300,000, as you have for a number of years, and there was a child benefit article for Sacred Heart of $45,600. That operating budget now includes the $239,000 that were approved for the teacher collective bargaining agreement year one. And I've bundled that together now. It becomes part of the operating budget. So total appropriations of $20,768,000. So that's where we start. Where we're going is that the default budget we'll walk through first and talk to you about those items that are prior year, plus or minus any contractual and legal obligations, minus any one-time appropriations, and we'll build the default. The default is a $255,000 increase. It's a 1.25%, and the default budget on the warrant will read $20,679,275. Beyond the default, there are some adjustments, some requests being made in the proposed budget, and so the proposed ends up being $43,425,000 lower, which is a deduction from the default of 0.2%, leaving you the $20,635,000, which is a net increase of $212,000 and a 1.04% increase over the current year. Now let me walk through what I try to use, which are components, if you will, or bundles. First, one of the big cost drivers, obviously, is labor. And the biggest pool of labor we have are the teachers in the schools. This default budget includes the contractual increases for the teachers according to that collective bargaining agreement, We have actualized the budget for current employees. So you've adjusted for the hiring and the comings and the goings. We're budgeting for year two of a four-year agreement that we voted back in March of 16. And just to remind you, that agreement that we voted for offers 1.75% increase to those at the very top of the scale. It's a 12-step scale. Now let me reference your budget book. In the under the info tab, you don't have to go to it, but under the info tab, you could see it. You could go if you like, but there's the teacher scale for next year, the para scale for next year, the classified support staff for next year. All of those are in there in case you want to reference back and see those. So if you're at the top of the scale or beyond, you are a 1.75% increase. And for those who are in the scale, they get the step increase, and the scale moves underneath them by 0.5%. That was what was agreed to each of 4 years in that collective bargaining agreement. There are no changes in the staffing proposed as a part of the default budget. By definition, it's the same as the prior year. That category calls for $94,771 of new money. So the second category then is the other labor union we have, which is the paraprofessionals, the CESPA. We're budgeting for year three of their four-year deal that was voted the prior year, March of 15. That agreement calls for salary increases of 1.75 as well, and the employees advance a step in their scale. These are the paraprofessionals. There are kindergarten aides, our special education aides working with identified students in our buildings. We're adding two para positions here. These are a roughly $18,000 a year salary position, salary if you want to cut wage for a para working in any one of those categories. In this case, our IEPs, our individualized education plans for our identified student population, already anticipates or predicts that we'll need two additional special ed paras to meet the needs of those federally mandated IEPs to provide services as appropriate to those identified students. Total dollars new here, $48,280. Please, Brian.
Is this kindergarten?
These are anywhere K-8 or preschool through 8, because these aren't the kindergarten aides in the classroom.
Right.
These are a one-on-one aide moving generally during the day with a single student, providing support.
So they could be classrooms. Anywhere at any school.
Those two depends on where they assign people. Those two are not specific to a school right now. They are specific to students, one of whom is in one school and one is in another school, right? So without being too specific about special ed kids, yeah.
I get it.
So yeah, right now that's a district-wide assignment. And it's really driven by student population that we know now. Today, as I'm putting together and making the photocopies, the director of special service, the director of student services says, "Oh, by the way, guess what's coming?" And it's a changing reality over the course of the year. But we've based this on our best projections right now for what next year will look like.
And it doesn't hurt to stress that you're budgeting for a year that does not begin until July 1st, 2017,
and won't end until June of 18.
Yeah. Correct. Yeah. Just a quick footnote in terms of special education. The district has been able to stay well under the district average for numbers of students in special education. The average around in the state is about 15% of the population in your school district will have special education needs. Now, those needs vary. So it could be learning disabilities. It could be somebody with developmental disabilities. It could be speech and language, OT, PT. It goes the gamut. But in Hampton, we're running around 12%. So we are under state average. Lots of efforts are made by our classroom teachers to provide supports within the classroom before they need to go to an IEP. But when a student comes to us and is new, like today we have a new registration, or tomorrow we have a new registration, we have an obligation to provide that service with that when that youngster comes in with the IEP.
And in the current school year, you are working with English as a second language youngsters, 30 plus of them,
right,
which is another challenge for the district.
Right. Those youngsters do not have an IEP. However, they do require specific and explicit instruction that allows them to learn English. But because in Hampton, we immerse them right into the regular ed classrooms, so it's amazing. With the support from our, we have two teachers now, supporting those youngsters and immersed in regular education, the progress that those youngsters are making has been phenomenal. Every year we have to test those youngsters and we get a report back about how they achieve, and every single one of them are reaching their annual measured objectives. So we're very pleased with the progress. And again, I emphasize this all the time. Nathan probably is tired of me hearing it, but you know, our teachers are very skilled and they're very competent, and because of that, it alleviates some of the problems down the road. So sorry, Nathan,
nope.
I didn't mean to cut in.
No, please, anytime. Jump
He's
in.
He's nice.
This.
He lets the ladies talk once in a while.
Once in a while.
Okay,
it's,
sir.
It's hard. It's hard to get a word in with me. Hey, listen, New Hampshire retirement, you've probably already talked about in other elements of your responsibility. The rates on teachers, so the contributions that we as an employer will make for our teaching staff, is rising by 10.8%. The non-teaching employee category is rising by 1.9%. The rates are included there for information's sake, but the total of that category in New Hampshire retirement is rising by $180,000. It's our single greatest, well, one of our greatest cost drivers in this year's budget. All of the other benefits are increasing a total of $21,629. Health insurance is going down by $3,000. Our guaranteed maximum rate increase. We are a member of Health Trust. We've been given a guaranteed maximum to work with for budgeting purposes. We'll find out in the spring what the rates will change to July 1. We're in the July pool with many of the school districts and some municipalities. Our guaranteed maximum increase, 1.7%, was the lowest in the state. We'd like to attribute that to our health and wellness initiatives and the work that's being done. We understand that it's hard to rip out data to show that, mm-hmm. and that there are lots of other data elements that go into the rate settings, but we certainly appreciate the support that the staff have afforded us in following these initiatives. And obviously, health and wellness, when it's positive, drives attendance, which is better for the continuity of instruction in the classroom. But it also pays off in your rates sometimes. And so our 1.7% increase, as we projected, was still less than what we have in the budget this year, because last year we budgeted for the guaranteed maximum and the rates came in slightly lower. And so that margin that's in our financials this year that will be part of the surplus is enough to cover what the increase could be as a max next year.
Just to give you a quick idea about how impressive this was, the highest increase in the state was 30%. There were municipality districts that had an increase of 30%.
And the average was about
13%. 13% average across the state. So for us to come in at 1.7, we really feel like the work that we've been doing around wellness and with our staff, this is focused on our staff. I mean, the kids get that too, but this was all around our employees, all of our employees. And as a result, for the last 2 or 3 years that we've been working on this, we're beginning to see some results. So hopefully we'll keep that going.
That's amazingly low.
Oh, yeah.
Mind-boggling.
It is.
I was a group insurance underwriter.
We were suspicious something was going on because they asked Nathan and I to present at a workshop at the state. And well, we didn't mind doing that. And we talked about Hampton and what we're doing in Hampton and Nathan's work with the Teachers Association and finding good plans and ones that were cost effective. And I was doing the work around working with Mary Borg. Mary's back there in our nutrition program and making sure we were talking about healthy ways for our teaching staff, using the available resources through the Health Trust. And so we presented at a workshop, and then they turned around again and they asked us to present again. I sent him.
You gave me an audience.
But we knew something was up. We knew. And then when we got this in the fall, about a month ago, a month and a half ago, we were really really blown away, quite frankly.
I'll let the numbers play in our favor this time. That's great.
Yeah.
Dental insurance not rising at all, staying flat. We haven't seen an increase in dental of its on its own merits in, I think, the last 5 years. Our dental rates did go up a small amount last year because we changed plans. And for what was less than a 5% growth in the cost, we doubled the coverage. We had a plan that was covering $750 a year max per individual. We doubled that to $1,500. And so it's a more robust plan and cost us very small money more. And so that rate stayed flat. We appreciate that. Our costs did go up a little bit in dental because we have more people taking the plan now. One of the downsides, if you will, of increasing the value of a plan. So $21,000 in all benefits combined outside of the retirement costs. Another significant driver this year, given all of the conversation that we had a second ago about special education, is in special ed. The needs increase and grow. Identified students move in and move out of the district, and depending on, that's really the hardest part of the budget in terms of projection, which is why we maintain the special ed expendable trust fund. There's a little over $215,000 there, held by the trustees of trust funds against the fluctuations that we might see in any given fiscal year. But as we budget for next year, what we recognize is that even in the current year, our tuition costs are rising for out-of-district placements. It accounts for, on that one line, a $240,000 increase for next year. It is offset by some costs, though, because when students move into out-of-district placements and you start paying tuitions, you see some of your related services in the district that you were providing fall away. We're also shifting. We have a new director of pupil services who's brought new eyes and has found some great ways to hopefully find greater efficiencies and do more with the taxpayer dollar here in terms of providing services. And so in the notes that are included under your info tab, there was a reference made to a BCBA, a board-certified behavioral analyst, a position that we'd like to create in the district as an employee rather than a contracted servant, if you will. In this case, the analysis, the dollar-wise analysis, was there provided along with the conversation about the duties. We pay approaching $100,000 a year right now for the services of a BCBA working with our students. Most of the services, though, are delivered by assistants who come, and the BCBA themselves take credit for evaluations and the sign-off and the supervision, et cetera. Yeah. For the same money, we can populate internally our own BCBA, who will provide lots more direct services with their certification and knowledge, while also adding a couple of stipends to a couple of paraprofessionals we've talked about and creating our own assistants who can help provide additional services. We'll end up with way more services being provided, probably better, at same or less cost. She brought it to us as a part of her budget proposal. We thought it was outstanding. It's essentially a net balance because we'll shift the same dollars out of contracts and into salary. So, but all told, with some of the net savings, the total special ed is actually up $188,559.
One quick question I had about this, and something we've been discussing in the town, is this person is going to be paid more than the other ones that have already been here.
This isn't a teacher. This is a brand new.
Right, because I saw we took this out of the budget 2 years ago.
Never had one.
Right, well, it was down to a dollar.
Right. Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the BCBA, we have the BCBA contract, meaning, you know, vendor, you know, a company contract through two different agencies over the last 4 years. We have had them coming in and providing that service. They're not the easiest positions to find, mm-hmm. put in a school. We have a hope that we'll, you know, we're Hampton, and there's a draw, yeah. and we're hoping that will come. But you can see that the salary range that we've placed on this is in the 60s,
mm-hmm.
And so it certainly doesn't approach what your veteran teachers are making, but we think that can draw someone in. And then we'll actually have that person and be able to save dollars as well, for instance, because they'll be able to provide services to the summer program instead of us, again, contracting further for that service. So mm-hmm. In the years that we've been here, we haven't actually had a BCBA on the payroll.
Right.
But we've contracted with a number of different agencies, and we were able to shift in the past. We've shifted that cost at times from the district budget to the IDEA federal grant, and the federal funds have paid for that at times.
Mm-hmm. And will that, is there a chance we can get those anymore?
In this case, we continue to receive the IDEA grant. In this case, we're budgeting right now to use the contracted dollars that were in the operating budget, but that means that frees up the grant to pick up some of the OT and some of the PT and some of the other therapies that we contract for.
And how long is this contract going to go, do you know?
This employee will be on a year by year.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
The incredible thing that some of us who've been here from the beginning when SAU 90 came into being is the incredible amount of flexibility and reviewing every single year. It's nothing is stagnating. And that has impressed me tremendously. There's a full-blown review every year. We need this position. We don't need that position. What are our needs this year? It's been very inspiring to watch. And I'm continue to be impressed.
Thank you. I should also mention that if you were looking line by line through the budget, you saw a $34,000 line show up where there wasn't one before. The summer school program has been buried in our contracted services, our professional services, yeah. And we agreed it was time to pull that out. It went from $43,000, I think, down to $36,000 this year, in the budget did. But we put it on its own line so that we can monitor that and budget for it directly. So all of the other elements of the default wrapped up in this next slide, which property and liability, we have a 3-year program that caps the increases. Our property and liability could increase as much as 10%. We've budgeted for that increase, but I think we're going to see it come in lower. Mowing, unfortunately, is a driver. Our mowing contracts, we've bid out the last 3 years, two of the last 3 years we've bid out, and the costs have simply risen. We were in the teens, and now we're up over 20,000, so we've made an adjustment there because of the contract that we have in place right now for the mowing vendor, to the contractor to come in and do all three schools and regular upkeep out at Toll Farm at Batchelder Pond. That's $12,000 worth of increase. In the area of transportation, our first student big bus contract for home to school transportation daily, that's rising by 3%. That's a 5-year contract, and we're budgeting for year year four. And then, again, talking about some of our out-of-district placements, we have some increases in student transportation, mm-hmm. specialized transportation to move students to those placements, $38,000. All of these increases are offset in large part because we also have a reduction in debt service. So the Marston 1996 two-story addition, including the gymnasium out back, that bond has matured, and we wrapped up our final payment in August of 16. So as we move forward to next year, the principal and interest payment of $335,000 goes away.
Mr. Pierce? That's what you've been focusing on.
Mm-hmm. It's important to note, though, when we will only briefly look at revenues, I assume, like we normally do, One of the big revenue impacts is that 30% of that principal was coming to us in state building aid. You know, we've been talking about our Hampton Academy project, and there's no new building aid right now. We're hopeful that the legislature might finally come around on that and lift the moratorium moving forward. But the building aid on what they call the tail has been maintained, which is they're continuing to pay, in our case, 30% of principal over the 20-year bonding of our project. Yeah. They're continuing to pay against the center school project, too, for 2 more years. Mm-hmm. So we see the budget of $335,000 go away, but there's also about $100,000 worth of revenue that won't be here next year.
Good.
And then all of the other things combined add up to $6,900. Did Sonny have a question?
Yeah, I noticed, so I believe, well, you're going to need a new roof on the Marston.
We've already completed the first phase of probably a 4-year cycle. Mm-hmm. That roof, Mr. Lessard, and in his infrared scans each year and all the patching that they've done, this is the original Marston School. What we call the third grade wings of that airplane, yep. And the 75 wing heading out back, Everything that's one story. And so we broke it up. The estimate initially was about 800,000, maybe 750, depending on how we would bundle it together. But it's so far what we did was we tackled about $200,000 and did a piece of the one wing and the main lobby and principal's area and part of the cafeteria. And then what we anticipate in this next year is moving forward and finishing the annex and the cafeteria, the kitchen, and doing the other wing. And then we'd probably need 2 more years to keep going.
Are you considering using steel for the roof?
I would say no. I don't. It's not, steel isn't what we've put up there. Of the specifics of it, I'd probably defer to Mr. Lasard if you had questions about the contract. But it's not a steel roof. It's a modified...
Is it a membrane?
Modified... Modified...
Keith,
want to dig me out?
Talk about the roof. Come on.
I've been up on it. It's outstanding.
Keith, use this microphone over here.
It's probably a flat roof.
Just tell us about the roof.
Yeah, they are flat.
Membrane.
Just whatever it is you're doing
flat
up there.
Roof, yeah.
It's a modified built-up roof is what we're installing.
Okay. No slate.
This is not our slate. It's a low pitch roof. It's actually not flat. All those roofs have a slow pitch to them. It's a modified built up. I think it's the best of old school and new school. It's a triple layered roof membrane. Then it is, we use heat, we use hot tar in between. It's kind of the old fashioned way of doing it. So then we're going to get a solid substrate of, fibrous materials, triple layered, so the substrate becomes solid. Then we put a cold coat over it, and we add river stone or washed rock on top of it. So that protects the layers underneath. The stone has a lot of area if someone's going to do the math, so it's quicker evaporation. It also absorbs the energy from the falling snow and rain and hail, so you don't have a direct impact on a single EDPM roof. So we're looking at a long-range product. A lot of people think that it's expensive. You probably could save a little bit of money, but in the long run, you get a better roof, a more solid roof, and one that's going to last longer. I'm lazy. I want to do it right. I want to do it once. And this is the roof we're having, and we've been very satisfied with this roof. This roof, when we did the same process when we were doing center school, all except for the 99 edition.
Keith, estimated lifespan of this type of roof?
We're talking 45 years versus, EDPM, which came very popular during the first energy crisis, and they're not holding up.
Go ahead, Keith.
You don't go on that roof and shovel it off, do you, in the winter? You don't have people.
Good question.
Ah.
Good question. We've had some huge major snowstorms or years with major snowstorms. We have removed snow from certain areas. Most of the time, it comes down to the superintendent and Nathan and all the phone calls we get about, are the roofs unsafe? Okay. Our roofs, even with our modification and modernizing them, increase insulation, have a snow load capacity that handles for international building code that's on the books today. There's a certain amount of deflection that's allowed to that. Shoveling the roofs. When they're necessary, we will shovel the roofs because we get high drifts or something like that. We are very cautious. We do not go down to the membrane. But what we do is we maintain corridors or paths between the roof drains and to the edge of the building. So when it does melt, it has the river to go down to the roof drains in the roof and leave our site. So we're not gaining extra ice. We're trying to avoid ice. We get some ice, obviously, but and that drains down. So that's been our approach to handling the questions of excessive snow drifts, and to protect the occupants of the building.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you very much. These
are, Keith, thank you very, very much.
These are very serious conversations that we have, and I don't ever mean to make light, but if you have a chance later, I do have some great photographs taken of Old Man Winter up on the roof with me last winter or winter before, taking core samples to measure for snow load and to make sure. And he's a treat to follow out there. If I'd been in boots instead of my leather uppers, I think I'd have been in better shape on the ladder. But
but Keith has made an excellent point here. Do it right so you're not having to deal with messes every couple of years. And that keep that thought in mind when we talk about the renovation project. Okay, Nathan, go for it.
Please understand, too, that this is a very sensitive subject for families and parents.
You know,
they want to be assured that that building is safe when there's a snow load. We actually had Nathan and Keith up there conducting tests, taking samples of the snow, melting it down, and measuring the weight.
Wow.
So that we understood exactly how much weight was on that building so that at no time we put any of our children in jeopardy or our teaching staff. So we take that. Nathan wasn't kidding when we took that very seriously.
Very important. But at the same time, you don't want to be up there with a snowblower.
No, we're
because
we're,
you'd be putting a roof on the place every year.
Right. No, we're not doing that.
All right.
So I summarize. All of those elements that we just described, those dollars total $255,935. The default budget's a 1.25% increase over the current year.
I do have a question.
Yes, sir.
While we're on that, the bonds and so forth, you said you had one at the end of this year, and you have one a couple of years away.
We'll make our last payment in August of 18.
And how many other bonds do we have besides those?
That's it.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. So there's the default budget. Now, the things that aren't protected by law obligation, by definition, are the requests. Mm-hmm. Some of them positive, some of them, savings. Mm-hmm. So the first, let's talk about staffing. There is in the budget a proposed nurse assistant position. So currently, we have an RN, a registered nurse, that are certified by the State Department of Ed as well, a school nurse. We have a school nurse at each of our three buildings. Center, Marston, and Hampton Academy. We also have a paraprofessional position that has essentially been filled by a CNA or an LNA, mm-hmm. Certified Nursing Assistant, and that para position has been in support of specific student medical needs, and it was at Marston School for a number of years, and now it's been at Hampton Academy, and that position will continue to serve needs of individual students where best or where most appropriate in the district. But the medical needs of our student population continues to grow, both in the number these are not identified, so these are not necessarily IEPs. This isn't necessarily a special ed matter. This is a medical matter. These are health issues.
Allergies.
And so some of them are allergies, and there's any number of other that need monitoring. They need support. They need different levels of support or kinds of support, depending on the age of the children. Mm-hmm. And so as these... I wanted to use the word severity, and I said it's growing in nature. Mm-hmm. But some of them are coming along, and they're just more significant. And it is becoming a very significant issue for RNs who already have, as school nurses, a full plate in our buildings. And so one of the ways that we want to try to address this is with not another RN, but in this case, a nurse assistant that we intend to staff with an LPN, a licensed practical nurse. We have done some market analysis and comparisons on what we think the rates would be to provide an LPN during the school year. I don't think that we have an answer right now for specifically where that LPN will be assigned. Here's part of the vision. The idea is that this person might not actually work the school day. They might come in a little later because we really should have some first responder nursing support in the after school where we have an ever-growing number of students participating in academic and extracurricular after-school programs. And so maybe that person's schedule can start later in the morning and run until the after-school programming is done. That also means that we have an individual who's already here and available when we have an RN. We have a field trip. We have a nurse that's out sick. We have a professional opportunity for someone to get some continuing education. One of the things we've struggled with most in these years that we've been here is securing nursing substitutes. So it provides us a lot of, again, flexibility and opportunity to meet some growing needs. and we can do that at about $27,000. And so the school board was supportive, and we've added that to the request.
Thanks.
Yeah. Got a question. You know, on bullying, you mentioned a good example is you're seeing a lot of bullying through tweeting from Washington. What's happening with the kids, the young kids, because, you know, they're right on the internet, and they're, you know, the social networks. How are you handling that?
Sonny, we have computer education teachers, and part of the work that those teachers do with our kids is learning the appropriate protocols and etiquette of being on the online using their various devices to communicate. I'm not going to tell you that we haven't had occasions when youngsters went too far and messaged somebody or tweeted somebody that was inappropriate. But we have a very, very specific and a very strong policy on bullying. And that's not just a bullying, physical or verbal. It also includes cyberbullying. Yeah. So when our principals or our teachers discover that somebody is cyberbullying, then that becomes part of the disciplinary process. Sometimes that happens at home. But often, if it does happen at home, it comes into the building, and it creates a hostile environment, and the principals engage with those students and their families to correct that behavior. I don't like it from adults, and adults are doing it, so we have to help train our children about the proper way to use these devices, and that's part of their learning.
Good.
All right.
You have a question, Maureen?
Yes, I'd like to the idea that you're going to have are hopefully having an LPN. There are certain things that LPNs are not able to do. Am I right? How are you going to substitute that person for an RN, or are you not going to do that? What is your plan there?
So the school nurse must be an RN.
Right.
Statute doesn't direct that you have to have, for instance, an RN in every building all day long, every day. An LPN can do a lot more under the supervision of an RN. So okay. One of the ways that we can do this is that the LPN, just as the CNA or the LNA does today, work under the supervision of the RN in whichever building that individual is in, the LPN will work under the supervision of the RN. So the real exposure, quote unquote, will be if the RNs have all gone home for the day and the LPN is alone from 3 to 4 in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. But the kinds of services and the kinds of coverage we're talking about providing will be things that are well coordinated with parents, and they're the things that in the normal course of events today, first aid certified folks are responding to, or 911 is called. So it's a better level of service, but it won't expect something beyond what their certification or licensure will support and allow.
Okay, good.
Right.
Go ahead.
And so what would be the liability of this person, if they're on their own in the afternoon?
No different. I mean, obviously, they're school employees, so they're covered by the same blanket policies that cover our nurses and our administrative staff and all of our faculty. They really will only be operating within the definition or the scope of what their licensure allows. It's more of an active first aid, first responder in that regard. Obviously, anything that was beyond what the LPN should deal with, they'll call 911 and our emergency management, our emergency response teams here in Hampton are very responsive and very quick to the schools. So,
my only other obstacle, I thought, was as far as going with the sports teams or being with the teams, do you have, what's the word I'm looking for, coaches or trained emergency people with the teams? Because I know they travel quite a bit.
So our coaches are all first aid and CPR certified, trained, have to be, so that they can provide that kind of first response. In many cases, the host, here's another reality, I think another, the host sites have their own emergency response, as do we. In some cases, there are trainers and other health support staff who are available to act as first responders. But when a group of kids get on a bus and go, whether they're going on a field trip or they're going to an athletic event or some other extracurricular, they are accompanied by somebody. In most cases, it's the coach or the advisor who is CPR and first aid certified. The nurses, the LPN, if we had this nurse assistant, when we talk about going on a field trip and needing a nurse, we're talking about something beyond that initial response like you'd get with first aid or CPR. It's specific needs, it's monitoring, it's medication, it's something that really steps beyond what the teacher or the coach wants to be doing.
Is it special needs?
Not necessarily learning needs or disability, mm-hmm. It's medical needs.
Right. Yeah. Okay, because I could see this as a scheduling nightmare for that one person to go on.
When I brought it to the administrative team, what I said is we ought to have two or three of these. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, I think I might let go of the health aide once I had one in each building, but each RN could certainly benefit because of all of the paperwork and the monitoring and the moving about through the building and the touching, you know, being with the student to monitor, to record, to be there and make an active decision supporting the child and their wellness. I could definitely imagine having an LPN in each building, but you only bite so much. We try to do this, you know, logically. So right now we have the CNA, the health aide, and we'll add an LPN and we'll see how that goes. But it would not be unreasonable to suggest that I might smile at you another year and say, I want to add another LPN. This is working really well.
So. I'll make a note of that. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Nathan.
We, as another request, we have a reduction. Last year in the budget, we added $90,000 for curriculum support. We have been in a curriculum review process that the superintendent initiated shortly after we started here in 11, looking first at the core elements, math, language arts, moving now into science and social studies, mm-hmm. reviewing the curriculum in the multiple areas in the schools, and considering best practice, considering standards, et cetera. In support of that, the board offered some dollars to help implement some of the recommendations coming out of the curriculum review process, the curriculum review committees, et cetera. But we've moved to the end of this cycle with science. We have that happening this year, but as we look to next year, those were dollars that we were proposing to take back out of the budget. Because we've now made progress in implementing on many of the elements that we've been in the curriculum review cycle paying attention to. So that's a $90,000 reduction. We talked under the default budget about the teachers and the paras who have collective bargaining agreements. The remaining staff members in the building include the custodians, the secretarial staff, the technology team, your administrators, and food service, I didn't note there. Under your info tab, there was a colorful document that looked like this.
Oh, yes.
If you like, it ties out to this page. So I'm just using that information. The budget anticipates or requests a 2% wage and salary increase for all of the people in that category. And again, it notes them there. In the budget book detail, you can see the individual positions. I summarized it there so that you'd see it in on one page. Additionally, all other wage changes. We have a change in tutors, substitutes, after-school programming, summer technician we added back in, and we reduced an HR assistant position. So when we came to you, I guess it was a year ago, we asked for an HR position, a part-time position in the superintendent's office. And I won't restate all the reasons why we thought we would do that, but we effected an initial hire, and that person lasted about 6 months, and I guess they're inherent in that reality that they lasted about 6 months was that it didn't work, and the individual left, and we have not filled the position since, but I think we found that it didn't serve the needs the way that we had intended. We could not find in the marketplace somebody part-time with the skill set and the fit. And so in the conversation with the board, it was decided that for now, especially given the desire to keep the budget as low as we can, recognizing some of the default increases we couldn't mm-hmm. control or avoid, and wanting very much to make all room for Hampton Academy, et cetera, we are taking that out. So the net decrease there is $23,000.
Okay.
All other benefit areas, because of the salary reductions, fall by $13,000. And then the miscellaneous category adds up to $17,000, including some additional software and online services. So many things that we do in the classroom, of course, we've gone to a one-to-one initiative now with the Chromebooks, but we're finding that now we want to use this tool, and we want to use this tool, and those all require some online licensing. Supplies and equipment rising by just under $10,000. In the area of legal fees and dues, we've been made a reduction of a little over $5,000. Another $2,100 wraps up that $17,000, and when you add those all up and summarize, you have a $43,000 reduction, which shaves the 1.25% by 2.2%, and that leaves you with the proposed operating budget of $20,635,850, which is a 1.04% increase over the previous year, and would, by oven by itself, represent a tax impact of a little over 6 cents against today's base. Sunday's got a question.
You know, I hate to keep talking. You've got some children that don't speak English. How are you integrating? How about your handling it? How are you integrating?
God bless you. Sunny, we have two staff members who deal with youngsters that are learning the English language, and they spread themselves out between the three buildings. But all of the children are integrated into regular education classrooms, mm-hmm. And they're supported by their teacher and then supported by our two.
How many kids are
we there? Have 34 youngsters that are currently receiving services. And they come from all over the world. Again, you're never sure who's coming. You never know who's going to walk through the doors. But we are prepared to help those students.
Okay.
So, that is the budget. I guess I would take your attention to revenues briefly before we wrap up operating.
Excellent.
So the revenues, what I provided, and there is a full length 8.5 by 11 in the back of your packet. It will arrive for your viewing at page. Looks like 20. Page 20. So it's just in from the back. The revenues. Three big areas are driving changes in revenues as we anticipate them for the coming year. One is we've had some windfall, if you will, from the return of surplus from what was local government center is now health trust.
Mm-hmm.
In the current year, when we set taxes, that's about $160,000 of revenue. So just briefly, they have an operating year. They finish with surpluses. The new law or regulation limits what they can hold on to for reserves. These are all the pools. Anything in excess of what they can legally keep as a reserve, they have to return. And we've been calling it return of surplus. And so we get that return of surplus, and we then identify individual by individual how much they paid in, how much of that, or how much was paid in on their behalf or for their coverage, and how much of that was district money contributed and how much it was individual dollars. We do this for all of our actives who are participating and our retirees. Of course, with our retirees, it's 100% their contribution. So we break down and we pay back to all of our actives and retired employees their share.
Sorry, Dave.
And the remainder of the dollars is a general fund revenue going back to the district. So this year, in September, it was $160,000, roughly. There isn't a return of surplus this year. So as I anticipate revenues next year, and I haven't had a chance to communicate this fully to my staff or my retirees, but those that I've spoken to, here's the thing. We got what we asked for. They are anticipating rates more carefully, I guess, and their surpluses at the end of the year are within the reserve limits that they can keep, so there is no surplus to be returned. And so we're not getting any, and so we're not returning any to the staff, nor are we returning any as a general fund revenue. So that's a major change in revenues, although that's only been a new revenue in the last 3 years. So the second star here on my graphic is under building aid, and I talked briefly a moment ago about the $100,000 that we lose in revenue from building aid because we simply aren't paying out the debt service. And the third is the fund balance. And candidly, we gave back $446,000 last year, or 2 years ago. We gave back, I got to look at those numbers. 446 was the actual. Oh, the MS-24 that I just did, we're looking at 400 and a quarter in fund balance. But as I look to next year, it's hard to think we're going to keep at that. We've been shaving, and so I've anticipated 310 as a fund balance. So that's another 100,000 plus in shortened revenues. So,
and you're projecting like a year and a half ahead. I mean,
It's a long ways out. So yeah. That's yeah. Our presentation of Article 2, the operating budget, $20,635,850.
Okay, and we have all of the detailed documents in the back. For everybody to go through, and do anyone have questions that they can think of at the moment on the operating budget? Because it's, you know, every tab, every sheet, I mean, amazing detail in here. Okay, Mr. Pierce?
I have a question. It's the same one I asked, I think, every year during the budget. A lot of actors in your environment, like FTE. That doesn't mean a thing to me. Okay. I wanted you to have a glossary of some of the acronyms you use frequently, because I know you, in your environment, you all know what they mean, but I'm not in your environment, and I just go by the everyday stuff. And FTE, for example, doesn't mean a thing.
Full-time employee. Full-time equivalent, in my case, because it could be, an FTE could be two half-time people. When I add them together, they're one full-time. That's one position. So an FTE is a full position.
I appreciate that, but wouldn't it be nice to have a glossary?
It would be great, and I could put that right under the info tab and put a glossary in there of all the acronyms. I'll do that.
That'd be great, because I've always asked this question practically every year when I start going through the budget book, because there's a lot of terms you folks use, which are fine, but they don't happen to click with me.
If there's, I would say, listen, if anybody caught a couple of those, FTE is one, I'll go through and try to find everything that I can. But if there's anything else that jumps out at you, drop me a quick email. Just say, add this to your glossary, because I think it's a great tool to have. Thank you.
Sonny?
Yeah. The New Hampshire Retirement Fund, they project 7.5% return. They earned 1%. There's a big problem coming down the road. You know, at some point it's going to hit down. You know, that's what I'm struggling with. You know, when my kids were small, we lived in Newton, Mass. I chaired the PTA council. The total budget for the city of Newton was $30 million. You know what I mean? You know, you saw what happened with SAU 21, the school budget. Northampton, Hampton Falls rejected it. You know, the rest of the world is not on defined benefits retirement. You know, I'm struggling with, you know, how to handle the future.
The impact of the retirement, Sonny, occurred over a long period of time.
I understand.
There was a time when the state contributed 35% to that retirement fund. About a few years later, they reduced it to 25%. Mm-hmm. And then they reduced it to 0%. Yeah. And they expected that the responsibility of the pension fund for educators fell on the backs of all of the cities and towns. And that's why you've continued to see your portion of retirement go up for not only for your teachers, but for your municipal employees. Right. And they work on it every year at in Concord, but they've not been able to do anything, because if they change out the system and they start it with the new hires, the problem is the new hires feed into the system, which pays off your retirees. So do you see what happens? They've not been able to get out from under a defined benefit.
Yeah, no, believe me, I understand. For example, I'm on Social Security at this point, you know, fairly elderly. And actually, my Social Security is going down because Part D took a big jump. You know, and a lot of Hampton residents are in the same boat. You know, I would have no problem with giving cost of living adjustments to employees, but, you know, public service is one of the few areas that and senior executives are the only ones that are really riding on the curve.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, in all fairness to our teachers, there's a first-year teacher starts out at
$40,000.
They all come to us with a four-year degree, and many of them here come with us with additional coursework. So when they come, they're taking lower salaries. I'm not saying that they didn't choose that profession, because they did, and I understand that. But with that choice of being an educator came some benefit. And one of the, I started teaching, I won't tell you the year, but I was making $6,300. Well, that retirement benefit for me when I started.
You couldn't be married in those days either, also.
Say that again?
You couldn't be married in those days, right?
I beg your pardon. But Sonny.
He says Laura Ingalls Wilder.
Way to get us some good ones, my friend. I was. I admit, listen to the staff back there. They're loving this.
A lot of smiles in the back.
But it wasn't quite that far back, Sonny. I want to be clear with you on that. But the point was, try a little bit later than that too, thank you. But the point was that we had salaries, and there's other people in this room that started back many years ago. And one of the benefits to the teaching was a retirement. Mm-hmm. It was. I'll be very honest with you. Yeah. We didn't contribute much, and the towns didn't contribute much, and the fund grew.
Yeah.
Now it doesn't happen that way, and now they want to take it away from them.
If the accountants who are overseeing this and overseeing the retirement investments could understand what a real percentage of return is, it might cheer everybody up a little bit.
Well, we'll see as the stock market, as you've seen in the last month or so, the stock market has been booming. So obviously the monies that they put in.
Today.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see. Yeah. But unfortunately, that retirement fund is everybody's. I was in Exeter about a month ago with legislators, and that was the number one topic.
Yep.
With area legislators and their concerns about the retirement, both at the in the school departments as well as municipalities.
Now, if we are pretty well set, you've all had your books for a couple of weeks, you've had a chance to go through. Are there any further questions or comments before I call? Because we will finalize this budget tonight.
So we're going to vote for the...
Oh, absolutely.
Budget. That's good with me.
Regina?
I just want to make an announcement. Flat budget was at 1.04%. Great job. Great detail. The warrant articles, everything. You guys do a great job. I'm so glad that we have such a great school system in Hampton. And I just wanted to let the board know, the audience know, as a member of the Board of Selectmen and as a representative to the Board of Selectmen on this committee, I will be abstaining on voting tonight. But I hope that everything makes it to the town to decide on, and thank you for doing such a great job.
I will remind you that the representatives from the precinct and the school and the selectmen, once they sit at this table, Ginny, right?
You and I disagree on this.
They become a member of
Janet.
This committee. And yes, I found that out personally 38 years ago. And you are entitled and supposed to participate with this committee like any other member, and you are supposed to vote your conscience, because you are the one sitting here, the Board of Selectmen, the school board for Ginny, and the precinct representatives cannot tell what their appointee what to do by voting.
No one tells me what to do. And I will be abstaining from voting tonight. If you can say yes, no, I'll abstain.
I just wanted to do
a little introduction before I just blurted out abstain. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Henderson.
Yeah, I'm going to echo what Regina said as far as tremendous. I mean, we all know that we have tremendous teachers in this town. We have tremendous staff. Mr. Looney, just a fantastic job with this budget here. Everything's clear. It's right to a point. There's very few questions reviewing it I'm sure I can speak for myself, but I'm sure most of us, everything's laid out nicely. And just a fantastic job, and wish you well with the budget and with the next school year.
Thank you.
Thank you very
much. Barbara, who made the motion on the total budget?
I did.
Jenny did.
Okay. I wasn't done yet.
What?
I still had a couple more questions.
Okay, go for it. Because I've got the engine turned on here.
Yeah.
Mr. Henderson.
Assemblies.
Yep.
That's seems to be growing exponentially. Is this for more security?
Where is it?
Especially from 14 to 15.
Where are you?
I'm coming. We went from...
I'm on...
You're on page 1404, right? Your student assembly is under extracurricular.
Okay.
Yep.
So this is another one of those categories. We talked about, in the past, we talked about field trips.
Yeah.
Assemblies are another one that... We budget $3,000 for each of the buildings, but they spend more than that over the course of the year, and they're supported by the PTA and other donations in their student activity funds that are managed at the building level.
Okay.
So the board and the district budget provide them $3,000 essentially as seed money. You can see that in 15-16 they did a pretty good job of using it up. In 14-15 we would have done. I have to go back and look. I know the academy used their dollars, but it must have gotten classified in the wrong account, and so you didn't see it here when we actually put the document together. Brian's actually finding that in 14-15 the total is about $6,000 because academy is zero. But if you put academy back in there at 2,900 or 3,000 and they use it, you're back to 9,000 again. So they use it each year. Just that year we must have charged the wrong account.
Okay. That makes sense.
David may have just paid for it out of pocket, actually. Yeah.
And at this time, we should give a shout-out to the PTA and also the Box Tops. Yep. Box Tops, by saving the little Box Tops, we've made over $4,000 or $5,000 that went to field trips and activities. So thank you to the community for saving Box Tops. Thank you to the PTA that donates a tremendous amount of money to our libraries and our schools as well. Mm. So thank you for supporting the PTA and the Box Tops.
And tremendous support from parents, because I can tell you from personal experience, the schools all have marvelous support from the parents of the student population.
We had an extra $10,000 for bonuses.
You did that last year, and so it stayed in there this year, yes.
It's not...
Okay, because it showed as...
It's not bonuses.
Well, we were calling it merit payment.
Merit pay
there was
bonuses.
A decision made last year to call it bonus payments as opposed to merit payments. But that was an initiative that the board launched 4 years ago or five. Mm-hmm. The notes are in there in the book. The initial motion that was made in the year it was made, and then the changes that have been made subsequent to that.
Mm-hmm.
And so, a year ago, the board made the decision to increase... It had been $50,000 when it was first conceived and the initiative was first launched. That was reduced but to $30,000 2 years later. Mm-hmm. And this last year, it went to $40,000.
That seems like quite an increase.
It's a lot of staff in the schools, Brian.
This year, it changed last year. Right.
Now, this isn't just the superintendent. This is done by committees.
No, this is done by the superintendent.
Just by the superintendent.
Right, based on evaluations that are completed on all the staff that are eligible for the increase. They have a performance review, an annual performance review, and based on that performance review are allotted a merit increase. And no merit increase is the same because they're all very different.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, but you already had the... $30,000,
which was down from $50,000, which was the original, and now we're going back up and added 10.
It's in 2290.
And it goes to non-union contracted.
Right, non-union employees.
How many people fall into this category?
38.
So you got to look at that.
Yeah, a lot of
staff
here.
It's a lot of staff.
Right, but I'm seeing. Anytime I think of bonuses and things
it's
like
merit
that.
Pay.
Bonuses.
Merit pay. It's merit pay based on evaluations.
It does not accrue to the base.
Right.
It's a one-time payment. Yep.
Right. It doesn't add to their salary every year.
Right.
And I understand the question it's not changing in this operating budget. It's that the number's staying the same from 16-17 to 17-18.
And my last one was wasn't DPW. And I know I'm asking a really silly question, but wasn't DPW going to help you with the moan?
No.
I mean,
a couple of years ago?
Not to my knowledge. We haven't gone there. No,
I know I'd be really stretching it.
But they, it's a good time, good opportunity, as Ginny said, to shout out and say thank you.
They certainly do plow, throw down the sand and the salt, and support us when the snow season comes. Mm-hmm. The trash and recyclables go away from the school. Yeah. We just seem to keep throwing it out there. Have you seen that little video about the guy who says to his wife something about the magic table? I leave stuff here, and in the morning it always seems to be gone. I put my clothes in this basket, and they always seem to be clean. I haven't figured out how that happens. It's the house of magic. Yeah. It's kind of like that. All that rubbish goes out there, all those recyclables, and it just seems to go away every single day. And
oh, that's great.
We appreciate the work that they do and how supportive they are.
Yeah. And my only last little thing is the special needs people that you have working for you are some of the most incredible people I have ever seen or met. I have contacts, but I just can't give out enough support for what they do, because they really are a big line of, I don't want to say defense, but they do a great job with the students, and so thank you.
Good. Okay, Mrs. Bridle has moved, seconded by Mr. Henderson, that we approve the 2017, July 1, 2017 through June 30, 2018 annual operating budget of the Hampton School District SAU 90. Would you, Barbara, read the motion, the amount of the motion again, please?
$20,635,850?
Yes.
Okay. Everybody comfortable? In favor? Unanimous. And Ms. Barnes is abstaining?
Yes. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Nathan, it's a joy to work with your budgets.
Thank you.
Now on the special money articles.
So the first article is article number 3, the long-term maintenance.
Mm-hmm.
Again, this year, the project plan is for $300,000, consistent with what we've been doing. It's a non-lapsing project with a two-year horizon, and the continuation of the article is, as it has been for a number of years, an actual listing of the projects being considered. And of the $300,000, $230,000 is earmarked for the Marston Roof project that we were talking about. I won't take a whole lot of time tonight. I was on the roof the other day with a roofing consultant talking about what piece we should be budgeting for, what's next on the horizon. You can only have so many conversations in the community at one point, and right now it's most important we talk about Hampton Academy. He really thought that there might be some savings if we could finish this up and find a way to finance it over the next 3 years, or 10 years for that matter. But instead of having them mobilize and come and do roofs every summer on that same property. So I certainly will keep you informed, and we'll be talking to the board. Right now, the lion's share of these dollars want to go to Marston's roof. And right now we're taking, I forget the number of squares. He talks in squares on the roof, but I don't remember how many squares we were talking about. But finishing the annex and the kitchen and everything out front, and then the other third grade wing, and then leaves what probably will be another $350,000 to $400,000 worth of work beyond that. But we'll tackle that. We have we've undertaken an initiative to replace countertops and sinks in the elementary schools, Center and Marston, and we want to continue doing that. One of the things that we talked about at the board level was in reviewing water quality and taking samples and the like. We identified some code issues that needed to be addressed.
Uh-huh.
One of them was those traditional sink tops that we had that co-located the drinking fountain with the soap dispenser and the cleaning, which historically made perfect sense because it kept all the wet right here. But when you consider detergent of some sort with drinking, those no longer, the plumber said, I can't put that back. That has to go. And so that project is going simply because it's time. There's corrosion. There's rollback. These are the original in most cases. So, we added that to both. We have secured and now used a supplemental grant from the Emergency Management, the Homeland Security. We secured $24,000 to help us with upgrading our digital camera system at the schools. We did it at Marston and at Center,
and we've waited at Hampton Academy because we didn't want to string up a whole bunch of new equipment and install it only to dismantle it and move it. But we anticipate moving forward and making that a part of the project or bundling it into the project. So we have put a new digital backbone in so that we can archive and record and then review digitally, which is way better than the analog system we put in some number of years ago. We have kept most of the analog cameras and pumped them into a converter box that allows them to be recorded digitally and saved. So we didn't lose any of our investment from the past there. And then we have added a couple of dozen digital cameras. All of this really is external property monitoring, surveillance for security purposes and review around the buildings, the playgrounds and the like, and lobbies where we have traffic coming and going that might need to be recorded. So we've done that at Center and Marston School. That's the first significant of our security improvements that were driven by the security analysis that was done both by an independent group, the Ogons group that we had come in, and by Homeland Security here in New Hampshire. So we've added some additional dollars. Would love to talk offline if there are questions about some of the initiatives that we're launching. We try hard not to talk online about a lot of the security things that we are undertaking, but you see here there was $20,000, $25,000 in last year's article for each of these two buildings, and there's 15,000 more. So we've done the cameras. We're moving forward now with some of the other security improvements that have been recommended, hardening rooms, creating safe spaces, and trying to do our best to protect against that which could potentially come. And again, it's not about making our schools fortresses. It's about making sure that we create opportunities and buy time for our outstanding first responders to be on site. So, that's the article.
I would move to move forward with this article recommended by the Budget Committee.
Seconded by Mr. Plouffe. One question, and this probably can't be done, but I say this, Ginny knows, I say this every year because this goes back to when Ginny and I used to sit in the library up there with the snow coming in the windows working on the budgets. Representative Mike Edgar and Art Brady were the school board members, God bless them, who in 1986 requested that this article be placed in, with the school to maintain the buildings. This has been a tremendous help over the years, keeping the buildings as best we could maintain. I'd wonder if there's some way we could put their names in this article. It may not be possible, but I thought, per school board members, Brady and Edgar, in 1986, this is the annual maintenance article. Really, someone who does something that has lasted this long and the foresight that those two men had in advocating for this. I was just reminiscing a little bit and thinking, sure. I don't know where Mr. Brady is at this point in time, but of course Representative Edgar is representing the town of Hampton, and it just takes me back, and I think how smart they were and how farsighted they were thinking of the schools.
I'd offer two comments. One, in response, I don't know about adding language to the article, but certainly we could make note in the next annual report and draw attention to that, and we could do that as often as we like. Connected to the warrant, because there's pages. Yeah. I've got a place in mind where I think that note could go.
Ginny, what do you think?
I think that's great. I mean, people think that late meetings are 10, 11 o'clock. We went to 1:30, 2 o'clock in the morning in the old days.
Yeah. With coffee and cookies.
With coffee and cookies and snow. So it wasn't bad.
It wasn't bad.
But bless their hearts. Are you ready for the vote?
Hold on. I
have a second comment when you're done.
Oh. Okay. Please. This is where I have to, I've got to put this in. Last year, actually this year in February, I went to the academy for the grand tour. Okay. Now, I want to specifically talk about the Eastman Gymnasium. I can't remember for sure, but Dave, when I went through there with you, was it a pipe that broke during one of the vacations,
yes,
a water pipe, and then the whole floor had to be replaced?
In January. Yeah.
Okay. During that really, really cold weather. Now, At the time, there were a lot of buckets. And you said that the roof, when it rains certain times, you have to put buckets out?
Yeah.
Yep.
Is it still doing that?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, I know that you want to get the roof fixed with the big project.
Mm-hmm.
But when you have a roof that leaks, you've got to fix it. And this is where the money would go. I'm just making a suggestion. I don't know what it would cost to fix it, at least so it doesn't leak. That would be a priority. If my roof was leaking in my house, I'm going to do more than put a bucket out. I'm going to do something about it. And it's already been a year that, you know, the thing didn't pass, so we didn't get any fix at all for that roof. But this is the warrant article where it would go. And I don't know if, Keith, if perhaps you have a, off the top of your head, you know, $100,000 or $300,000 or $1 million. I don't know what kind of money we're talking about to at least repair it so it doesn't leak.
I think our goal is to have a new roof over our heads.
I realize that.
The slate roof has exceeded its lifetime
expectancy.
Yeah. Toughest thing with the slate roof is we do go out there and we do repair it and we chase it. Our biggest problem with the slate roof is because of the wear and tear of the rain and the snow, and the slate is growing fragile every year.
Mm-hmm.
We go up to replace one or to find where it's leaking. Okay, we've got copper valleys and et cetera, that the copper with the acid rain and the mm-hmm. different minerals that are falling from the Midwest onto our roofs here in the East Coast are eating away at a lot of the metals. We do not have a cost to replace that roof. We haven't gone there to find out a cost to replace that roof. We do not want any leaks. And we do use this money that you see there, $5,000, and then sometimes we're using the
operating
budget to cover the cost. We need to bring a lift in first, a huge man lift. That's $5,000 a week, generally speaking, if they need to get up on that roof because they don't want to walk on the roof.
Yeah.
Because when they walk on the roof, they're breaking every tile on the way up.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, we need to replace that roof. We need to get the Hampton Academy project mm-hmm. passed.
Yep.
We do not want any leaks. That's why we do the infrared scanning of all of our roofs, and I'll explain to you that what that is. If we're going to talk about roofs, let's talk about them, okay?
Mm-hmm.
We do infrared scanning. When a roof leaks, water goes into the insulation.
Mm-hmm.
Wet insulation does not have any R factor.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So when the infrared cameras scan the roof, the color is red because heat is escaping.
Mm-hmm.
See it.
When ProScan does, that's the company that we use, Steve at ProScan, when he does that, He does that at night, and he marks it with white paint so that our roof repairing team can come in and see where it is leaking, replace the insulation, repair the roof, stop the leak there.
Mm-hmm.
At our meeting, we talked about the roofs at the academy. I love Public Works, too. They work very hard, but I'm going to draw an analogy to some of our roofs on the academy. Ian's Lane. Okay, we can see where the patches have been done on Ian's Lane.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, our low-pitched roofs at the academy resemble that.
Yeah.
Okay? The slate roof, very few people even want to work on it. The skill set, the talent in our country is not there to work on slate roofs.
Mm-hmm.
They're busy on the Harvards, you know, the deep pocket learning institutions that want to maintain that curb appeal. I know we would love to, but I don't think we're going to.
Mm.
So it's very difficult to get people in to do it. It's a small job. We do get people in to do it. They do patch it up. Then the next thing you know, it's someplace else.
Yeah.
And most of the time, the leaks are following the rafters
yeah.
and then falling into a certain spot. So we have repainted the roof after we patched it, and I think Dave has been there for a few years now. And he's seen the barrels move around the floor.
Oh, yeah.
It's not always the same place on the floor.
Okay, so then you've answered...
We have complete...
You've answered my concerns is that it's not just... You are trying to fix it.
Yes.
You're chasing it around.
Yes.
When they put a slate roof on, what's under it? I know with the asphalt, they put felt paper or something,
yeah,
but
that's,
is it felt paper?
Tar paper, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yep. Okay.
Okay.
All right, well, thank you. Thank you, Keith.
And that's a good work into the next article.
I'll vote on this.
Yes, we're trying to vote on this.
No, I'm going to make seven.
Okay, Mike. Okay.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
Keith? Okay.
I'm sorry.
Mike?
I'm just going to say, when you have a leak in a roof, it's leaking down on the rafters, the 2x4s or 2x6s, they're all going to get rotten, and then you will fall through the roof.
You're right.
So we're making a hazard if we don't repair it immediately by default.
We are repairing it immediately. Yeah. The problem is that because that slate is so old, 75 years old, we find a new place. So we are doing that, Michael. It's just that we
can't keep up with it.
We're not
keeping
up with it.
Time has come, the walrus said.
We need a new roof.
Yeah. Okay. Our structural, just to follow up on that, because the public is watching this, we have had structural engineers looking at that through the renovation project, proposed reconstruction of the academy. And they have not pointed out any substantial negligence on maintenance of rafters or of the decay due to insect or a rot.
Mm-hmm. I appreciate that, but let's assume for a second that the warrant does not pass again. I think sooner or later you're going to have to
when we talk about the proposal, we're going to mention, going to talk about that, Michael.
Yeah. Keith, so we're going to be talking about this on the renovation article. Why don't you take that seat like a nice gentleman, because you can use the microphone. Well, I'm sure we're going to be asking you more questions on the renovation article. So
I don't want to distract anybody. I'll sit there and I'll come back.
Oh, all right.
Thank you.
For that.
Okay.
So here's my last comment, Madam Chair, if I may. In the very beginning of this packet I gave you tonight is the warrant.
Right.
The language that's there is the correct language, and I apologize, I found a mistake. I had the same mistake last year. We wrote the article specific to Marston and Center School, and if you read the article that's printed here, it says to include blah, 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 at Hampton's Marston and Center School buildings and grounds. The article had previously said, and in the slides it says Hampton's three schools.
Yes.
In deference to a comment that was made, we are not planning to spend those dollars on the academy projects because we're promoting a project at the academy.
Right.
We continue to use district operating funds to support the maintenance projects that need to happen there.
Right.
But I just wanted to make sure that when you vote, you're voting on the correct language that's in the warrant. My slide needs to be amended.
Okay.
Thank you.
Now, are you ready? We've got to get into the renovation article.
Yeah.
You're ready to vote on the $300,000 maintenance article. In favor? And Ms. Barnes is abstaining.
Thank you. I would move Article 4, as recommended by the Budget Committee, to school district meeting, to budget hearing.
I'll second it.
Okay.
Very quickly, you've done this. This is a history of supporting Sacred Heart. We are supporting 41 students, K through 8. They are all Hampton children. Every year you ask, are there other districts that support Sacred Heart? I talked to the principal, and yes, Seabrook does support their youngsters over at Sacred Heart, but that is the only district. Mm-hmm. And again, these funds, the $39,000 that they're requesting is based on enrollment. Those funds are monitored. They can only be used for certain categories. One of them happens to be nursing services, technology.
Right.
And whenever they request the use of these funds, a purchase order is done. It is reviewed by either myself or Nathan, and then it goes into the system for their payment. So there is this isn't just a check that we give to Sacred Heart. They have to justify their expense.
Mm-hmm. Early on in my budgeting experience, I questioned this article because I was not used to public funds supporting a parochial school, but that is allowed under the RSAs for functions that the parochial schools cannot provide that are provided to the public school students. So this is allowed by statute, and the article has been on the warrant for quite a number of years. Sonny?
Yeah. First, I want to say, you know, if all the departments presented their budget the way you do, our job would be a lot more simple. This article, I say the same thing every year. You know, I have a problem using public money for a private school. Mm-hmm. If it was a mosque, I said this last year, it wouldn't pass.
You know what I mean? Yeah.
I tell you what's wrong. You know,
he says the same thing.
The state is passed so that businesses can contribute to Sacred Heart and get a tax credit. I just feel, you know, it's
okay.
They're using Tuck Field, even though they have a recreation area. They're the biggest user of Tuck Field. You know.
Sacred Heart?
Madam Chair, the citizens' petition
yes.
has been received. The clerk has had a chance, the school district clerk, who's
excellent.
Also the town clerk, has reviewed it. It has 25 or more registered voters signing.
Excellent.
So that's real at this point.
We appreciate that. Okay, in favor of...
I have another point to make, please. They historically, somebody from Sacred Heart come in the budget committee and plead with the case.
They will come in at the public hearing.
Right. No, they used to come to the meeting.
Well,
too.
In the old days.
Yes, they did.
Yeah. In the old days, they did. You're right.
But they avoid it because they don't want to be given a...
No.
I don't know why they didn't come, but...
They were here last year.
Yeah.
They'll come in at the public hearing. Okay, time is wasting here.
It will be at the public hearing.
Yes, in favor of recommending this to the public. What are you doing, Sonny?
Excuse me.
Thank you.
Who's the second here? I don't think we
The second
was Mike Pluff.
Was Mr. Pluff.
No. Steve Henderson.
Mr. Henderson, okay. All right, try this again. In favor, so we can count? Okay. Ms. Barnes is abstaining. And Mr. Sonny, what are you doing?
No.
Voting no.
And he's opposed. Okay. Now,
the next thing is very exciting. The Hampton School Board has moved this article forward, recommended by unanimously. The Hampton Academy Building Committee has moved it to us unanimously.
Yes.
So I would move forward the Hampton Academy Middle School project for $25,950,000. Recommended by the budget committee.
I'll second that.
Seconded by Mr. LaBranche. All right, it's all yours, Nathan.
So, yeah, you want to start?
Okay. Yeah, let me start. I'm going to jump right into it. I think that, you know, there's why do we need to do this? And I think we had several discussions already tonight about why this needs to be done. But let me go through about why this is being proposed, and there'll be some schematics up there that I can go over with you. But first of all, you know that the Hampton Academy was built in 1939, the second 65, and the third phase was built in 1974. You can do the math. Those years, it has serviced this town very, very well. And I want to make that very clear. It is maintained by Keith and his department to the best of what that building affords to us. But it is in desperate need of repair. And I'm going to highlight those areas that I think are critical. The first area that I would like to highlight will be the upgrade to mechanicals. What does that mean? That's the electrical systems. Our electrical system, there are classrooms with one or two plugs. In 1939 and 1965, that wasn't, you didn't need it. You had one overhead projector or a slide projector.
Yeah.
Now we have computers and smart boards and all kinds of technology in those rooms. We must upgrade the electrical. Even outside, if you notice, we have a transformer right outside of our building, in very close proximity to our building. Totally inappropriate with wires running into the building. That all needs to be underground, and it all needs to be taken care of. That is a major, major issue. All of the boards are going to be changed out, and the power. So that's critical. The second area in mechanicals, obviously, is the air quality. There is no system of the air moving from outside to inside and keeping the air quality so that it's at a level that is healthy for the kids. Now, you'll say open the window, right? Well, the problem is that we have issues with the windows. We can't open all the windows. We've actually had staff that have been injured trying to open those windows. We bring in the custodians if we need to open a window. That is no way to keep the air quality at the level that we need it, especially when you're talking about the winter. You were talking about your budget meetings in the snow. I mean, that's no different. I mean, we have kids in a classroom. And
even in this building, may I? Yeah, you've got ductwork. You've got air return. The machine just flipped and turned on, and it sucked air out, and it pulled in fresh air.
Yeah.
There's a CO2 sensor here somewhere monitoring our carbon exhalation.
Yeah. Yeah.
You don't have that in a school where the kids are sitting captive 7 hours each day.
Yeah.
They've done what they can. They put ceiling fans in to try to move air, open the windows. But that's maybe the single biggest mechanical concern, is that you can't regulate the heat or the cool. You can't regulate the temperature. You can't move the air. There isn't any ductwork. It's the same in all of our buildings, but that'll be one big one.
And in addition to the area that's of great concern is the plumbing.
Yes.
And our bathrooms are just in terrible disorder. And we could go in right now and gut them. But we know we're talking about gutting bathrooms, then the cost is well over $100,000 per bathroom. You're going to spend $1 million on reviving all the bathrooms. And here's the other problem. We have sections of the building that we have no bathrooms for our staff.
Mm-hmm.
So we have teachers out in that sixth grade wing with no bathrooms. We have bathrooms in teachers' lunchrooms that are like right there in their lunch areas. It's just inappropriate space and not used well and decaying. We've had issues with plumbing because of pipes that are as old as those buildings now, just remember that, that need to be ripped out and replaced. And so along with the electrical and the air quality and the heating system, the plumbing system needs to be redone. When we talk about costs, I want you to keep in mind those areas that I just mentioned, because those have caused the project to increase in cost. That we specifically targeted those areas, and that's where we saw about a 4% increase in costs. So you got to keep that in mind when I continue. I think I've covered the mechanicals pretty well. We are going to be looking at safety. Nathan referred to safety. We still need to upgrade safety. Some of that is around traffic and the way the cars and buses come in and out of that, where the parents drop off. All of that in our project, and I'll show you that in a minute when we look at the layout of the plan. You'll see that we have rerouted buses and parents and all of our kids walking in to create a much more safe environment. Right now, we have kids standing out in literally a driveway where cars and people come in and out.
Delivery vans.
Yeah, it's just not, there's no place for the kids to go, quite frankly, other than inside the building. And so those are areas in the mechanical aspects of this building that we really want to address.
And we talk about traffic, but there's also internal traffic. And so part of the safety and security is about entrance and egress. It's about the width of corridors, lockers, and kids in lockers, plugging up the corridors, making sure that stairwells and the stair towers have appropriate rise over run so that... I mean, you can go to Hampton Academy right now. We don't fall down the stairs at Hampton Academy. We fall up the stairs at Hampton Academy because the rise is different than you would expect, and your toe trips up.
So
internal traffic is important as well.
So moving on, one of the areas that is critical now is our programs. And I'm going to start with special education. In 1939 and in 1965, there wasn't an ELL program. There was not an English language learner program.
Yeah.
We didn't have a social worker in 1939 or 1965 or 1974. Did we have social workers? But PT and OT and speech and language were very limited. Now all of those services are provided at Hampton Academy with no space.
Mm-hmm.
They're using restored closet space. They're using anywhere where they can, in some cases out in the hallway, but there isn't appropriate spaces for those kinds of services, and often those services are done one-on-one with students or in small groups. And again, it's a significant deficit in that building. Some of the classrooms that we use for the special education, where we have multiple teachers using one classroom, it isn't the best situation for those youngsters who have learning challenges and who often need a more quiet environment. So this project will allow us to upgrade those rooms to provide services for youngsters. In addition, we have got, as you know, we have school counselors and we have nursing facilities. There's no confidentiality. If you want to go see the guidance counselor, there's no place to wait to see her. You have to sit out in the hallway. Well, it doesn't take long for somebody to say, well, what are you doing out in the hallway? And that's not appropriate when you're a middle school age youngster. And it's just not. Same with a nurse. She could have two or three people in her beds in there, and she has people waiting out in the hallway. And that's not a good situation, again, for our students to be out in a hallway waiting to see those services. And just you see this when you go over to Hampton Academy. There's other youngsters that are waiting out in the hallway, and nobody really knows why. Well, sometimes they're waiting to see Mr. O'Connor. And I'm not always sure that it's just to have lunch with him, but that's not appropriate. If a youngster makes a poor choice in class, he shouldn't be out in the hallway for everybody to look at.
Yeah,
you make a mistake, but people come in and out of that building, and there's our students sitting out there for everyone to see, and it's just not appropriate. So, again, those essential programs and services that we offer do not have adequate space in that school. Classroom. I talked earlier tonight about core subject areas, and there are a number of classrooms that are not 900 square foot classrooms, but they're close. And we're not gonna dibble over 10 square feet or 20 square feet. But there are other classrooms like science classrooms, STEM classrooms, our library that are well undersized.
Yes.
Let me give you an example. Four out of the six science classrooms are regular 900 square feet. The state calls for 1,400 in a science lab. Think about it. In a lab, you have lab tables and you have water and all the other things that go along with a science classroom or a STEM classroom, and those classrooms are well undersized. We do have two, however, that meet that standard. And those rooms, when the renovation happens, will remain as science rooms and will just be painted and updated with electrical and all the other pieces. But we're not creating new rooms. We'll keep those the way they are. But four out of the six are substandard, undersized, and don't have the services that kids... They're regular classrooms, and they're not science classrooms. And quite frankly, in the age that we're in, this is a really important area for those youngsters at middle school level. So that's another area that we would like to see some attention. Lots of discussion about why would we need a gymnasium. Well, when you don't have one that you can use, you've got to have something. The gymnasium that we've already talked about, Eastman Gym, you can't use it. It's too small. It doesn't have the floor space. Then we say, well, okay, we'll do volleyball there. Well, I've seen them play volleyball, and they hit the roof because the roof is too low for a volleyball, so you can't use it for that. They've used it for wrestling, okay? But where are the mats? There's no storage upstairs. The mats are downstairs. So when the kids are wrestling, they got to carry the mats upstairs if they use that facility. Do you see? It's just not a viable gymnasium. The other thing is if you're playing there, the bleachers abut the sideline. So if you're playing, there's a very high risk for injury. Same with the downstairs. It has no seating capacity. It has a rubber floor. And it's not appropriate for, and we can't use it at all for games, for any kind of activity. We've been renting space at the Rim for both our boys and girls and for other activities, by the way. There are other things that we do that we need a big space, and we've rented the Rim. And unfortunately, we have to bus, adds to the busing, we have to bus the kids over to the Rim in order for them to use it.
Yeah.
I just think it's time. We've worked very closely with the Recreation Department, Diana and the HYA, and we've met with them, we've talked with them, And we know that, as you know, it's been very important to the schools to be a part of this community. So that school is not a school, it's a community school. It's a community facility. And it's open for all of the folks in the community to use. And this would be the gymnasium would be a wonderful way for that to happen. It will seat 500. It's a full-size gym. It will have a curtain that will drop down the middle so that you can have two activities, because we do have health classes and physical education classes that need space. We're able to do that. And when you have basketball, there are multiple rims so that you can have girls on one side, boys on the other, that kind of thing, so that it allows us much more flexibility for the kinds of programming and the activities that Dave has at Hampton Academy. Mm-hmm. I know that there's been a lot of talk about that, but I have to tell you that that's a very important part of the school day. When we talked about late school, that gym's being, those areas need to be used. The kids are after school. They're trying to, they need to be active and involved in clubs and activities, and we need that kind of a facility for that.
If I could just make one quick comment. 30 years ago, I was an Iowa official, and I came in to fill in for another official and went to that school and didn't even know why I was there, because there was no way that the gymnasium is big enough for a regulation court. Yeah. And we're only adding on to the cost by having to ship everybody out all the time. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to make that comment. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Steve?
It's unbelievable. There are no locker rooms.
Right. Mm.
There are what looks like some kind of a nightmare locker room for girls and boys, but they're not locker rooms. Yeah. At most, you might be able to change your clothes, and that's even a stretch. But there are no showers. There's none of that. It's not there.
No privacy.
It's unbelievable.
There's no rooms for the teams to join, you know, when they have a break during the game. Mm-hmm. There's no team rooms. I know that when we have, we don't use it anymore, but when they were using it, they would have kids in classrooms. The teams, the visiting teams, would be in classrooms. That's why we went to the rim, because it made so much more sense to have the facility.
A new gym would have
all of that rooms, will be there. There facilities. Will be girls' locker rooms, boys' locker rooms. There will be showers and a team room for visiting team and our home team. And again, I this is about the community. This is about all of our kids using a facility that is safe, sound, and meets all the standards that we need.
We had to get changed in our cars. We had to go back out and get changed
as referees.
Cars.
Yeah,
there are no lockers to put your clothes in and lock them up, or you know, it's just not there.
Okay. I want to go to one other place that has been concerning, and it's obviously on the list around reconstruction, and that's an auditorium. I think you've heard a lot about that. Mm-hmm. We are not building a new auditorium. We are just redoing Eastman Gym, and we're creating that into an auditorium. Because right now, and we are going to increase the space, because the problem right now at Eastman Gym, which David uses as an auditorium for assemblies and all kinds of things that happen in the community, there's not enough space. Dave can't put his entire school and faculty in that gym at one time. Yeah. It doesn't meet code. David often has to call over next door to the fire station and have a fireman on site. And it only becomes more difficult when you have visitors, when we have Veterans Day ceremonies and Memorial Day, or we've had parents are in coming in to see the kids, you know, perform and plays. We have issues, and we have not an appropriate facility in a community that values the arts, that values all of the dance and music. It's quite sad that there's not an appropriate facility. So again, I see this as a community space. Center School, I went to their concert. It was great, by the way. It was all those first graders. They were as cute as can be. They had to rent Winnicunnet. because we don't have a facility in Hampton for our other schools, for Marston and for Center, to use. If we had an auditorium, we could use that for all of our kids, whether they be Hampton Academy kids or whether they be Center in Marston. And honestly, it would be a great, you know, I remember bringing my kids, and it wasn't that long ago, Sonny, but Hampton always had, I couldn't resist, Hampton always had a playhouse, and I used to bring the kids over to the playhouse, and you always had lots of arts and drama, and that isn't here anymore, and I think it's just my opinion, but it's a missed opportunity for your community, because you have an active Hampton Arts Network. And you have this wonderful beach time, summer, with all the things that go on down there. Again, that would be, I know in Salem, they use their auditorium in the summer, rent it out, for summer plays. Mm-hmm. And you know, so we look at this as Nathan and I were thinking about it as a revenue source, too, because it can be that way. Mm-hmm. But not for a moment do I think that this isn't a valuable area for our school. Our students' standards in English language arts, listening, viewing, speaking. Mm-hmm. So our youngsters are involved in speeches and getting up and doing oratoricals, and this would enhance that opportunity for those kinds of activities for our kids during the school day. I think our English teachers were very clear with me when I met with the English department that this would be a valuable resource for them.
They used to call it elocution when I was a kid.
Elocution, that's right.
Just a couple of points, too. The wing that was put on in 1974, the sixth grade wing, and Nathan was mentioning something about crammed corridors and not being able to get through because the locker doors are open and so forth. We have had a tendency to build cheap in this town. And when you do that, the product is never satisfactory, and it's practically a waste of money. That sixth grade wing is terrible. It's always been terrible, and it will continue to be terrible until somebody gets rid of it. But the taxpayers' money was spent on that thing. Even when we were talking about the police budget with the police chief in the town, the police station at the beach is new, but he's finding already that maintenance costs are going up, because at the point in time in which it was built, I think it was 2004, certainly there was an opportunity for LEED certified buildings and the heat and all sorts of things, and of course we didn't do that, so I guess you could say that was at least partly built on the cheap. You end up by regretting it. The plan that's being proposed here is a 40 to 50 year plan. This should take care of the needs. I was in Mrs. Warburton's classroom a couple of weeks ago. She teaches science. There are two electrical outlets in there. There's no science table. The boxes up to the ceiling. There's no storage. The superintendent has been talking with Hampton Falls about the possibility of Hampton Falls tuitioning some students to Hampton. And it's a good idea. It would be beneficial to them, and it would bring in a little revenue to us. But what school wants to tuition out their students to a facility that is no longer really capable of providing for the scientific needs? And even the youngsters now are into producing TV, and these kids are all doing all this incredible stuff. And that's what they need to go out into the modern world. We're trying to assist them to get out into the world. We might, Kathleen, want to mention the efforts that came out of the study committee for some extra funding, like the Hampton Wave and so forth.
Right. As you all know, we have a facilities committee. About 20 to 25 people are involved in it. And they have been working on this, and I'm going to go over the design of the school really quickly with you. But we have a group of parents who have stepped up and are looking to create what we would call a WAVE foundation that would raise money for the school and for the district, actually. You know, initially it would be focused on Hampton Academy, mm-hmm. the monies that they raised, and then in years beyond that, they would support the other schools in the district. So Mike Muldoon and a number of other members are working on that, and it's got some real strong potential. So that's one revenue. We also know that we called and talked to the town, and there's $263,000 in impact fees that are earmarked for the school. And I had an opportunity to talk with Tracy Emmerich last week. And he's encouraged us to access that funds for the project. So we're looking at things. We're not, you know, we did, Nathan and I have been working with the Department of Ed and their team around building aid, and it's still not there. But we are ready. Nathan and I are ready to go to Concord. I've said this before. I said it to the selectmen. We will go, and we are going to plead our case. Because the infrastructure is as important as roads and bridges, because without a good learning environment for our students, they won't be able to drive on those roads and across those bridges. So let's get education taken care of here and as we move forward. And can I take a few minutes and go over this plan?
Just one quick thing, and Regina can confirm the selectmen have placed or have the article prepared to get the land to the school, assuming that the renovation
passes, it still has the same language that if the language passes, the town warrant has this, that the land would be transferred over to the school.
Correct.
I was passed last year without that language, so it's done. Mm-hmm. We've accepted it as soon as they pass it on. It passed.
I just wanted to make
sure didn't pass,
that was in this year as well, because we really have to do
so
this.
Let me just go really quickly through this, because you've all seen this a lot. You have it in your packet. It looks like this, and it's the same that's up on the board. I think that's the one I thought would be the best to go to. What do they have, Nathan?
It's also next to last in your other packet. A little bit bigger for you.
Yes.
So if you want to take a look at that. And look at the lower level. You'll see in the lower level, if you look at the bottom left-hand side where the lower level is, you'll see the gymnasium, the locker rooms, the bathrooms, all of that will be new construction.
And a new elevator.
Yeah, and a new elevator, right. An elevator that doesn't go out into a classroom or into the teacher's room or next to the bathrooms. It's awful. And then the current basement area with what I call the bunker and other areas will remain storage. Right now we have music rooms in the basement with no acoustics, and we have band, and it's just not an appropriate place for kids. So that will all be used for storage. We will be doing some work in enhancing the kitchen area. We have problems with the kitchen. It's too small. We're washing dishes next to cutting fruits and vegetables. We've been cited by the department to make some changes, so that those changes have been made to expand the kitchen. Our ladies in the kitchen didn't have a locker room, didn't have a place to hang their coats or put their pocketbooks, and appropriate restroom facilities are not available for them in that area. So again, we have addressed that in this plan. We've also addressed a program, and I referred to it earlier, still on the lower level, and that would be an area for our media productions, the Shark News, and a place that we can hold meetings that will be aired. We've been using this room, and it's hard because the town has so many things going on,
right?
And we would be able to do our own filming and broadcasting at Hampton Academy in that area. So we have a studio area. Not only will it be for public use and the school board, but for the youngsters during the day for their media program. That pretty much takes care of the first floor. If you go to the lower level, go to the first floor right above it. Again, you'll see that the red will indicate new construction. Well, the phase one is the gymnasium. That's done, so don't be looking at that. But what will be added to this will be a music area. It looks like we call it a knuckle up in the back. And you'll see that we have added a music room, a band room, and chorus, because we don't have any of that facility right now. They're using makeshift places that when we have chorus, it's a very popular program at Hampton Academy. Well over 200 kids participate in chorus. We don't have a place to put them. So she's had to break them up into smaller groups. The facility and the way it's been designed will allow us to do that, because you can see it abuts the stage. You see that? If you look at that plan, it abuts the stage. We flipped the stage at Hampton Academy, so the stage is in the rear, opposite of where it is right now. And that way our band, chorus, and music classes will be able to use that as an area too for their performances as well as their practicing. On Tuesday night at the school board meeting, we have a video showing and talking about the renovation and the current situation around music and chorus. So you'll be able to see that and get a greater detail for that. We also have a team up there. You can see one of the things that this building does, it brings our teams together. Middle school operates on a team. That means that we have four core subjects, and those kids stay together. And you say, well, why do they do that? Because they stay together, they have four teachers, it just improves communication, it improves discipline, and the opportunity for teachers to talk back and forth and to make sure that all they're on top of all their students' work. So for this plan allows that. Right now, we have teams scattered. We have some teams on one floor and the rest of the team is on the other floor because you can't match four classrooms together. This plan does that. It also provides space up there for special education rooms that are close by the team. The kids don't travel far. They're in their team area. And then they go right down the hall to their special education if they need to get some supports. It might be math. It might be English language arts for support. So that's the first floor. The other thing we did was when you walk into Hampton Academy, and you all, most of you have been there. As I look around the room, you've all had tours. And David's, David and I talked today, and Mary Louise asked us, we will make ourselves available for a tour. If you haven't been in and would like to visit, David or one of his staff members will be happy to take you. We'll do them at your convenience.
Yeah, call me and we'll try to blend the stuff together and get everybody organized.
I think Brian came last year and did a tour.
I've been too. Yeah.
Yeah. You know what I'm going to say.
I know what you're going to say. I'm expecting it.
I serve on a committee that has representatives from Hampton Falls and North Hampton. Okay. And I've raised, you're well aware that SAU 21 school budget didn't pass for those two communities. I've raised it with the individuals, and because I, for a couple of years, I've been advocating that you build a brand new school onto the Center Street School. Okay, Center Street School's got a lot of history. It's the oldest public school in the state.
Yeah, I know.
Common sense would tell you that if you start tearing an old building apart, you're going to run into all kinds of problems. You can build a brand new building for. In the long run, it'll be a lot cheaper. You could even build it with an indoor swimming pool and still come in cheaper. You know, when you get done with this, you're fighting.
Yeah, but we don't want to do that.
With the Department of Public Works, they've got, 30 warrant articles? You know, the infrastructure's been neglected in this town for, 40, 50 years? You know, if I... Actually, one of the warrant articles, the one for the force main from the beach to the transfer station, they've got the state looking at them, they've got the EPA looking at them. If something happens again, they're not going to be nice to Hampton, believe me. You can build a brand new school. They would love to, a regional academy. You bring the cost down for everybody because the other towns will contribute. You know, we're still going around the same tree.
I, as a member of the school board, approached Hampton Falls last year. Hampton Falls several times. Mm-hmm. Although the citizens of some citizens of Hampton Falls wanted it, the school board at Hampton Falls said they were not interested.
Right. Yeah.
This year, the school board of Hampton has voted not to approach Hampton Falls this year.
Yeah.
Well, you're talking us for you.
And Hampton Falls has now put on their budget a $7.3 million renovation project.
Again.
Mm. Northampton, we have not approached.
Yeah.
Seabrook would not be interested because they have their own middle school.
I'm going to scare all of you, especially Sonny. First of all, that the Academy building is a really treasured part of the community. Number two, if you should choose to build brand new in another location, the first thing that's going to happen is that the selectmen are going to want the Academy for their offices, etc. You don't want to go there.
It could be the courthouse also, and a senior center.
Yeah, well. Okay.
Except that I think it's important to note that nearly everything we're talking about, you'll have to do then anyway.
Yes.
Because you won't inhabit that building for all of the myriad of ideas that you might come up with without dealing with the mechanicals and the safety, the plumbing, the air quality. Yeah. Nobody should be put in that building to sit 8 hours a day, 260 days a year, without some kind of...
It would all have to be.
I mean, you don't go into any contemporary building today where they're not moving air. The fact that you got kids in there all day long without CO2 sensors and movement of air, it's crazy, right? So don't miss the fact that... Other communities in the seacoast have done it, where you build something new, thinking that you won't keep the old thing, but then you do, and you still put several million dollars in to upgrade all those mechanical systems.
You.
And you repave the parking lot, and nobody knows where I'm talking about, but you don't have to drive far to be there. So
we have to talk about the interest.
We know that, and Nathan's going to get to the price tag in a minute.
Mm-hmm.
We know that people were concerned about the price tag. Our school board is very aware of that. I think you saw in their budget, they did everything they could to level fund that budget without hurting the kids, because the kids didn't get hurt at all. But we made every effort, and we said no to, they said no to the HR person. They said, you know, we'll use funds in IDEA to help support our position. And they did everything they could. Because they know that price tag is scary, but a new building would have cost far more than that. In 2011, a new building at Hampton Academy was priced at $28 million and a renovation at $26 million. So I contend that 5 or 6 years later, we're still under that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so we got a great project here that meets the needs of our kids, meets the community for the future. And Nathan will get into the money in a minute, which I think is a great deal. But let me just go over a couple more things. In this project, and you can look at it in the purple on the first floor and other places in the building, we have an English language learner lab. We have special ed labs. We have a place for PT. You know, they need a room with the mats and other things that they do. I mean, we have youngsters that are in wheelchairs and have other, equipment that they need extra support in during the day. So we have all of those spaces now. Speech and language, they finally have a spot. Our social worker, our guidance counselors, we have a grant where we bring in a certified drug and alcohol counselor that helps children with learning about the effects of drugs and alcohol. So she's sharing a spot. So this plan addresses all those needs, and you can see that in much of it is in the purple area. Second floor just lays right on top of the first floor, and it just mirrors what's below it, so I'm not going to get into that, but it's all the team rooms upstairs. You can see that by the layout of, and then I think we have the art room upstairs, and our library has extended a little bit. We're able to open up that library a little bit more, so we have more space.
And the professionals that the school district hired to work on this were incredible, and they listened to us. They listened to the members of the committee, and they actually took some of our suggestions, even though they groaned one or two times. There was a lot of feed-in to get this all pulled together.
So Nathan's going to talk a little bit about the cost. Oops, I'm sorry.
Before you start the cost, I'm going to have something's going to be eating away at me the whole time. And I think you can address it during your talk, okay? And what I'm coming from is was the $28 million 5 years ago, and then the $26 million. We're doing this for $24 million.
Mm-hmm.
But I've lived through the big dig which was $2 billion.
Oh yeah.
$16 billion, and when they paid the interest rate off, it's $32 billion. Seabrook nuclear plant, double, triple, quadruple. So my question is, and I'm sure you've got it covered, that in doing the $24 million, I'm sure you've signed contracts, are going to sign contracts, or have discussed them in some way, that the people who are going to build it for us with the thing, it's going to have fixed costs. I'm making this up. So it'll be $24 million, and if it takes 3 years, it's not going to suddenly take 6 years, and it's not 24, it's now become 36. What have you done to discuss those things? And you can probably present it.
I'll present it. Excellent.
Great question. Great question.
So the costs in your second packet, it starts with some green tax impact. I'll do in just a minute. That's on the back. If you come in a handful of pages, the costs are broken out like I'm doing on the slide. It looks like this with our logo at the top left. Project estimate, project budget. It's page 8.
Yeah.
I numbered the pages and then forget. So,
the chair
mentioned the project team. Let me reference them as I go. So all through the summer, the spring and the summer and into the fall, this project team that we've been meeting with, this project advisory committee, which included our consultants, talked about different alternatives, ways to approach this project, changes that we could be considered. They questioned what would the impact financially be of making some of these changes, cutting out this or shaving off this. And all through this process, we were supported by a team of consultants who ultimately will become, we anticipate, members of our project team. The first hire that we did, if you want to call it a hire, the first contract that we wrote was with an owner's project management firm. Trident Advisors is out of Salem, New Hampshire. Mm-hmm. And the members of their team go to Gillette Stadium, Rose Wharf, big projects. That's their background. Yeah. This is a smaller advising team that makes their living as owner's project managers. The best comment that I heard was, "We'll be your conscience." And so we were led by Gino Baroni and Paul Panalina is his partner in this project. And with their support, we secured H.L. Turner Group as architect and engineers of record out of Concord, New Hampshire. Mm-hmm. And beyond that, we've selected Bonnet Page and Stone of Laconia, New Hampshire, as the construction management firm. So they have gone back. They were telling us in the spring, for instance, the superintendent referenced that construction costs were easily going to rise 8 to 12%. And so they've worked really hard with their estimates and with our design to contemplate ways to keep those impacts down. The costs that they have brought forward, $25,950,000, are broken down into three elements: hard costs, soft costs, and contingency. The hard cost, $22.9 million, is up from $21,895 last year. That's about a 4.5% increase, and that's the only increase that we've seen in the projection or in the budget. And that's really driven by the mechanicals we've been talking about, because the trades simply haven't recovered since 08 and the economic downturn, and that's only exacerbated a problem, which is we don't go into the trades anymore. We're very much a service-oriented industry economy, and there are high-tech and more professional fields, but there aren't a lot of young people going into mechanicals like the plumbing, the electrical, you name it. So that market doesn't have the same capacity that it did a decade ago, and as a result, as demand grows, supply is low, costs are rising. So
are you telling me we don't need plumbers and electricians for the kids to be trained in going forward?
Oh, we absolutely need it, and the schools are doing their best. That just the reality seems to be from the perspective of these consultants sharing with us about the industry, there aren't as many plumbers as there were a decade ago. There aren't as many electricians as there were.
There's a shortage of now.
That's what I mean. It's a great opportunity, and if we can convince more young people to move in those directions, great. But the reality is, when you go on site to this project and you see them all walk in,
you will be shocked by the age, relatively, of the tradesmen that come to do all this work.
Yeah.
Because right. they just don't seem to be able to cultivate interest in the younger generation.
Yeah.
They should, but they don't. And as a result, the supply is just doesn't meet the demand right now.
It'll be a $200 an hour for a plumber.
It'll be crazy. And that's exactly what's coming. And the MEPs, the mechanical, electrical, and plumbing, they can name their price is what's happening, because the more business that gets generated, the more construction projects there are, the more they pick and choose the ones they want to work on and then name their price. So that's going to be one of the cost issues that we're going to work to control. So, so hard costs are construction costs. That is your demolition, your new construction, your existing space renovation, site work. Although we're not doing brand new fields or anything like that. Our site work is limited essentially to the site and the parking and access, bus loop, etc. So those hard costs, $22 million.
Mm-hmm.
Soft costs are, I call them the related services. This is the contracts with our owner's project manager, with our architect and engineering firm. It includes furniture, fixtures, and equipment, another acronym, FF&E. In any project like this, you have an allowance for and an anticipation of FF&E, how much money in the project is going to support new tables and desks and chairs and new equipment that might be installed, like technology equipment and the like. We've made a commitment to try to keep 75% of our FF&E in place and make 25% investment with the project in new. The further commitment will be that we work ourselves into an inventory turn where we start to see that other 75 replaced over a reasonable period of time.
Mm-hmm.
We don't intend to walk in with all brand new classroom desks and chairs and cafeteria tables and the like. Many of those elements will end up being new, or some of those elements will, but our plan right now, based on an inventory that we took in the building of all that we have in the district and in that building for furniture, fixtures, equipment, is that we can salvage about 75% moving forward. Technology is another area covered in the soft costs, and we have about $150,000 allowance for the technology elements. But we have been investing, for instance, we've upgraded a fiber in that building in the last five months, because we just need to provide that kind of bandwidth to support the instructional practices and the use of technology in the classroom. And so a lot of the technology that we've been using will be leveraged moving forward, and we'll do everything we can to support that. So we've tried to keep the soft costs low. The other piece that's in the soft cost is commissioning, which is the third-party review and testing that is so essential to ensuring that we've protected the investment of the taxpayer. So you pour concrete footings, somebody tests the pour, tests the concrete, and samples that and tests it over time to ensure that it hardened as it was supposed to, and it'll have the tensile strength that it'll support as it was intended to by design. Do the same thing with steel and a number of other elements.
You're going to have somebody on site that tests the concrete, is that what I'm hearing?
They actually take, you pour this, and you pour this, and you pour this, and you pour this, and I take and sample those.
The big dig, when they were pouring the concrete, they're supposed to deliver within so many hours.
Right, yeah.
And they didn't do it, so they went back out again. Fabricated the approval permit to be brought in and brought in old concrete. I don't need 8 hours or 24 hours to set. And they poured a lot of the big dig with bad concrete. But to have somebody test it would be phenomenal.
But actually, take it away. That. We'll do that. We did it with when we did the two-room addition at Center School, we did commissioning testing all through. And it really is it's an insurance. Yeah. Insurance package of sorts to make sure that the design specs are being followed by your contractor. So,
Okay. So
that's all part of. I will tell you that our architect and engineering fees, we've negotiated at about half of what normal.
Mm-hmm.
Part of it is, I think that architectural engineering firm was hungry the day we walked in and said, would you be interested?
The timing
was right. I don't think there's any chance they let us have that rate today. But so our soft costs at $1.95 million stay mm-hmm. the same as they were. And then in response to some of the questions and concerns that are expressed about renovating, we have an owner's project contingency of $1.1 million. We have every expectation that we will avoid using some chunk of that, but we have to put that in to be prudent. There is very little earth we will disturb that we have not already disturbed.
Mm-hmm.
We will demolish the sixth grade wing, we will build in its place. We will pave over that which has been paved over before. So there's very little exposure to new soil, although there is some. There's a greater concern for sure about elements of that building internally that we will unearth things that we have to then confront.
Mm-hmm.
We've already abated every known instance of asbestos that's in that building.
And that's a lot of the spaces that have been exposed and addressed. So there's very little comparatively to some schools that we'll have to address, but still we have that contingency. All of that is wrapped into the project budget, which is $25,950,000. What we have with our construction management firm, Bonifage and Stone, with the support of our architects and engineers, and with the scrutiny of our owner project manager, and the review and support of the project advisory committee and the school board, is an initial guaranteed maximum price. So contractually, when we commit, the team must work within the construction costs that have been identified.
Do they also have time target dates built in?
There are target dates built in and times, and their general conditions are fixed as a part of that. General conditions being essentially the mobilization costs. I've got to bring a trailer on site. I've got to secure the site. It's hard to call it administrative, but the administrative and the business end of what the contractor has to provide is fixed in the general conditions.
And this will all be in writing.
And it's all in writing. It's
signed.
A contract. Yeah, absolutely.
Don't rise.
And so, what will come though is after. Now remember, this is all being done with estimates based upon concept. There aren't any blueprints right now. Like I can't roll out the stack of blueprints and go. So what comes first after a vote is that the architects and engineers have to go quickly to work to turn this into buildable documents, and then that will drive a final guaranteed maximum price where we'll have to do some. We'll have to do some design adjustment to make
my original question. Yeah. But you're saying now they haven't got the blueprints, they haven't done this, so they're going to give a final. I'm concerned the fine goes from $26 million to $30
million. It can't.
Is that a possibility?
No.
No.
We don't have the money.
No, because we've already voted in support. So they have an initial guaranteed maximum price that they're committed to working within.
Yeah.
What they have for flexibility is that built into their estimates, they have a construction manager's contingency, and we have a $1.1 million contingency. And so as we negotiate the final GMP, we have those to work within. But we have to stay within those. And what it drives, what it ultimately gets back to is that there could be adjustment in scope, but it's less about scope and it's more about choice. So Keith has an expectation of what he wants to put for a roof on that.
Mm-hmm.
And there's an estimate built in. But if steel prices go up dramatically in the 7 months or 8 months while we're designing, we have to make allowances for that steel. He may have to suffer with a slightly less robust roof than what he had anticipated. Those will be adjustments that we have to make, but all within some margin, because they have committed to deliver the general scope within that number. But we won't come. It won't be 30 million. And here's one of the nice things. Bonifage and Stone, we were in the middle of one of our meetings recently, and they were clarifying they have not they have not ever gone back and said, please float another warrant article and ask for another X dollars because we can't deliver the scope within. And one of the reasons why we made the decision with the support of the board early on to choose an owner's project management firm was we've got an owner's project manager who makes a living on avoiding that result. They will serve as our conscience, but they will also serve as their own best marketing agent and will deliver us within the budget that we've anticipated.
Yeah. Some of you may remember a couple of years ago the most recent addition to Center School. And I can remember Nathan standing in front of us at the public hearing saying, we will not spend one penny more. You are authorizing this amount, but we will not spend one penny more than we need to. And he came in under budget.
Under budget and on time.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Brian?
I didn't check the pest. We had the initial concept $86,250 last year. Did that pass?
It did. So that was when we floated a warrant article 2 years ago.
Yeah. Right.
$86,250. Yes. And that was spent in that first cycle on the owner's project manager and the architects and engineers.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Services to bring us to this point, and
right.
With all the pretty, the renderings and the pretty pictures,
mm-hmm.
We went back to the board this spring after the vote, and we talked first to Gino, the owner's project manager, and he met with the other two partners, and they came back, and we reported out to the board that if they would commit another up to $30,000, we could continue to work with that same team and run this cycle again to bring us to this vote. Mm-hmm. So we made that $30,000 fit in the operating. We found the dollars in the operating budget.
Okay.
And didn't, because we hadn't floated another warrant article, we'd only floated the project, and the project failed to pass. Mm-hmm. So they encumbered $30,000 and let us spend that on these same players.
Yeah. That was a good idea. I know you said architecturally and everything else, as far as the engineering is, we're kind of getting ready to start. Where are we engineering-wise on this plan? Are we at 5%? 20%?
I don't know that the architect would put us in the 100% range. I don't think that they would say between 0 and 100 because... Well, I mean, I guess fundamentally, you might say 5% or something like that. Okay. They haven't, what they have done is they have done what you've got. Mm-hmm. Like the floor plan that you've got, which is not to scale.
Right.
You know what I mean? I mean, it's pretty close. He's an architect, so he's not doing it. But it's not a design document. It's a concept document. Mm-hmm. And they have worked to put together minimum standards and expectations so that the Bonnet, Page & Stone construction management firm can say, that many square feet of that kind of material for that wall would cost this much with installation, labor, et cetera, take this long, it'll cost. And they've run their estimates based on all of that. So there's an allowance there for the kind of roofing that they would put on and the number of square feet that they would need and what it would cost normally to install that. And they've done that with every component, including the mechanicals, the electrical, the plumbing. But they've done that all as a narrative and as a concept as opposed to a specification. So when this project comes to fruition, there will be a stack of blueprints, and there will be a design spec document that'll be a foot and a half thick. Mm. That hasn't been written. This is a
schematic.
A schematic or a concept. So
well, that's why I say I think there was a great idea to keep the team together because they already have miles ahead of starting all over again.
Yeah.
And that's a concept that fits for them because they're on the hook.
Yep.
You know, if we're going to go to ballot on this, they've got to deliver.
Well, they know.
But they knew.
But it's their number.
There was no guarantee that it would go beyond that year. We only signed a contract with them for a year because if they didn't work out and they weren't compatible to Hampton and what we wanted, we were going to write them off and go look again. But where we had such a good working relationship, they were delivering the product on time and supporting us, we stayed with them.
And that's what made the committee so confident, because we felt we were in the hands of professionals, real professionals. And I think that added tremendously.
So the last piece to this is Nathan would like to go over the cost. And I think that's what everybody's sort of interested in.
So the back page of your colorful piece there, it's all green and orange or whatever came out.
Yeah.
How's it going to impact your tax bill? There's lots of approaches. It's my intent, I guess, to give you worst case. So when I tell you what the tax rate impact could be or would be, I don't assume that your tax valuations are going to grow by 1% every year, so that the mill rate will start to look lower and lower and lower. Mm-hmm. What I say is, if your property were valued in Hampton the same way for the next 25 years, here's the basic assumption that you can make. The reality is, as more industry comes to town, as they build more beachfront property and tax it, as they build more developments here or there, can't be a ton of that because we're fairly built out as a community. But as those things, I mean, we brought on a significant chunk of property in this last cycle. I know we revalued, but we also added several million dollars of new properties being taxed. So when that happens, it takes some of the burden off everyone. I don't bake that in at all. I don't consider that in any of these projections. So this is a very rudimentary kind of worst case approach. Using today's $3.3 billion tax base and working with right now the New Hampshire Municipal Bond Bank, which is a pseudo-governmental organization in Concord that aggregates bonding needs of multiple school districts, cities, towns, counties. They aggregate that and they manage their own bond rating as an entity, and they sell bonds on behalf of the organized group, which takes a lot of the the expertise demand off the local entity. We don't sell bonds. They sell the bonds. We just get the dollars and pay the bill, right? So they let the experts do. Although that's not our only option. There are other options that we will explore, assuming that the vote goes through, to try to make sure that we get the very best rates for Hampton. But they were anticipating right now that a 25-year bond for a number like $25,950,000 would right now bring rates somewhere, cost rates of somewhere around 3.75%, and that number's growing. We were at 2 and a smidge here. Yes. A month and a half ago, 2 months ago, right? So that number is growing, and the markets, I think, are going to reflect some of this in the coming months. But in the first year, we have a $570,000 interest-only payment. Because we buy in the June or July bond sale, mm-hmm. that first year we only pay interest, and then we pick up our 25 years with principal and interest. That $570,000 of new budget impact costs roughly 17 cents per thousand on the tax rate. That's new cost. That's so on the first $100,000 of property value you might own and be taxed on, that's 17 bucks a year. If you had a $400,000 home, that would be 68 bucks for the first year of new taxes. I'm not ignoring the fact that you already have a significant tax bill, regardless of your property value, but it's a new $17 per $100,000.
Yeah.
The subsequent year, which wouldn't be this coming fall, it would be the fall of 18 when you get your bill, our budget would have risen by another $1 million, $1,035,000, mm-hmm. to add to the 570 that's already there to make the first full payment of principal and interest. You would already have taken the whack on the first 17 cents. You got to pony up a new 32 cents, which is another 32 bucks a year. So in the first year, it's 17 cents. Every year thereafter for 25 years, it's 49 cents, if you're with me. Mm. That 49 cents per thousand is 49 bucks a year on every 100,000 of property value. So if you're sitting on a $200,000 home, it's 98 bucks. If you're on a $500,000 home, it's 245 bucks. If you're taxed in a $1 million property, it's $490 a year. Mm. The exercise that I tried to go through to make this manageable, to bite it down. And I think it's important, we talked about this at the facilities project advisory committee. If you have a $400,000 home, and this passes, over the course of the full 25 years, you'll pay roughly $5,000. We can have a debate if you... I don't want to have a debate. Let's not have a debate. Some people would say that good quality schools contribute to and support property values. Isn't it reasonable to assume that your $400,000 property is going to appreciate more than $5,000 in 25 years, mm-hmm. especially if it's supported by good quality schools in Hampton? Mm-hmm. So I know it's tax impact, and it's significant. And every new dollar being asked for is a difficult dollar to raise for some members of the community, maybe all members of the community, but this is a pretty, you know, I try not to editorialize, but I sit as a board member on a school board in another community where a project like this is going to cost us $4 a thousand, not 49 cents. And I don't know that community can afford it or will, but relatively speaking, boy, that's a pretty decent investment to make in your schools and in your property values, I hope.
That's the tax. A town similar to us, Auburn, had a building proposal last year, and their cost per thousand was $2 per thousand in their community. So when we tried to do some comparisons about what we could handle, this came in really well for us.
This is a side question.
David, wait a second. Steve had his hand up.
Yes. As I mentioned before, I was fortunate enough to take the tour. I went in there by myself in an afternoon after school, so we didn't disrupt as we went through the school, but I saw everything from top to bottom.
Good.
I think that anybody that has not taken the tour of that school should go in there. Mm-hmm. It's interesting, some of the things that you brought up tonight. It's interesting how my mind blocked all of that out. And you reminded me of some of the things that's almost nightmarish. Taking the tour, the amazing after school, what I was absolutely amazed by, how many kids were there still. Yeah. They were. There was a group of students practicing for a play in the new the auditorium. The Shark News with the green background, they're amazing. And if you haven't ever watched the Shark News, you've got to go online and watch it, because it's just amazing, the talent of those kids. But there were so many after-school projects going on and programs, and but you need to take that tour. You absolutely must. Everybody in this town should go through that building, because once they do, they'll understand. You know, so thank you very much.
My question was, I thought you had mentioned earlier something about the center school, and I was interpreting what you said. I may have misinterpreted. But
can't hear you.
That is due or needs to be redone in the future. What about the other schools, Marston and Center School? What condition are they in?
Center School, we did a Center School, which is our primary grade school, preschool through grade 2 on Winneconnet Road. Mm-hmm. We did a 2-classroom addition 3 years ago.
Right.
On the back end, finishing off the 1999 addition. We have done roof work at Center. We've done some bathrooms. There are some additional bathroom renovations to be done there for accessibility.
But you make me also think about plumbing, air quality.
Right. Air quality is something that the board has talked to us about. We're doing research right now for all of the schools. More philosophical conversation, you talk about lengthening the school day, lengthening the school year, changing the school year. Mm. One of the reasons why in New England we don't have school in July and August is not so much because we're so agrarian and we all need to be in the fields anymore, but because it's too bloody hot and none of these schools have any air quality addressed. And so with security measures, somebody suggested, oh, you should put bulletproof glass in. I raise my hand and say, if you put bulletproof glass all through the first floor, you can't open those windows. They're too heavy. You don't have any air conditioning. You'll suffocate inside. You know, this is your brain on hot weather. I mean, you couldn't do it. So there are certainly some things in the other schools, depending on how they'll be used, that would want to be addressed over time. But I don't know that any other than the roof work that we're doing at Marston right now, I don't think there's anything major in the 10 to 15 year horizon. Although in the schools, not only is air quality an issue, we've done some window replacement at Center School. We need to do windows at Marston. Mm-hmm. It's tough, though, because you're replacing windows and talking about R factor, and you can see daylight through the bricks down below it because they're not well insulated. So insulation is going to be an issue that needs to be addressed in the near term. But I don't... Anything...
The boilers have been done in the schools. Those $300,000 each year has been spent.
That $300,000 long-term maintenance has been a good tool and should continue to be a good tool to keep them
maintained. So overall, I'm hearing they're in good shape.
They're in pretty good shape, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Reasonably good shape.
Reasonably good. Yep. But this one, I mean, we have the 90. We just paid off the 96 edition at Marston, 96. And when you did the 96 edition, you cleaned up a lot of things in the other pieces of the building. We did a 99 edition in Center School, and you cleaned up a lot of the other things. Mm-hmm. But the last major work done at all on the academy was 73, 74. So
thank you.
Anybody else? Oh, yeah. Sonny.
I'm going to abstain, but let me toss this out. If it doesn't pass this year, we look for a regional, because...
Sonny, they don't want a regional school. SAU 90, 21 schools that are in SAU 21
right.
Do not, at this point, want a regional school.
You bring up an excellent point. Because if this does not pass, then in fact... We're going to have to piecemeal all of the issues. That means we're going to do the electrical. We're going to do it. And as you know, the sum of the parts will be greater than the whole.
Yes. Yes.
And it'll cost us more to do the roof and the safety and the traffic flow and the in and out of the building. All of those components will be far greater because you'll stretch them out over time. You don't have your workers on site. All of those things that make up project a little bit more efficient will not happen. But we have to do that, Sonny. You can't, this district cannot wait another year in hopes that the community will say, well, we'll give it another shot. Yeah. But
it cost us $1 million from last year.
Yeah, it already cost you $1 million.
Thomas says, you start tearing a building apart, you're going to run into more problems.
Well, we did.
If you've got your contractors locked in, you'll find a way to make a profit.
Well, that's why we have our project advisor, and Gino Baroni is like a dog on a bone, and I wish Keith were here. He calls Nathan and I tenacious. This guy is unbelievable. That's not going to happen. And we committed at Center School, and we did that on purpose because we demonstrated to this community that it can be done.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And I believe that this project will come in as it was, a guaranteed maximum, and we're going to work towards that because there's nothing worse than not being able to deliver like that to a community. I know you're kind of, like, ignoring me right now, but that is the belief that the school board has and that we have.
And you are right, Sonny. A regional middle school would make the most sense. But when all parties don't want it, you can't do it.
Well, you have to make a sale. Yeah.
That's what
you're trying to do now. So.
Sonny, okay. All right. Yeah, I'm going to make one more quick point here. I was skeptical when the suggestion was made to leave SAU 21 and form our own school district for the three Hampton schools. And I said to myself, well, gee whiz, they're going to want a palace. They're going to want 50 machines computers and stuff and whatever, and then it'll go up and up and the expenses will go. And I have to confess that while I originally thought it was not a good idea, this is the smartest thing we've ever done, and nothing gets by the business administrator who's sitting in front of me. Nothing. No, I mean that, and I never say that unless I mean it. Nothing gets by him. And if he says it's going to be X, I take that as a taxpayer, as a resident, I take that as gospel. We are so fortunate with the team that we've got for SAU 91.
But quite frankly, the board doesn't let us get away with anything either. I mean, they are very, very careful about expenditures. They review a monthly statement every month and ask Nathan, well, where did this money go? Yeah. How did you do this? How did that get spent?
There's not much gets by me at the dinner table either.
Well, now that you brought up Art Brady and Mike Edgar, yes, I have to bring up Rosemary Lemurs.
Yes.
Because if it wasn't for Rosemary Lemurs, SAU 90 wouldn't be as fastly put together, as well put together.
Right.
She had us doing our homework about everything before we did it.
You're right.
A lot of congratulations goes to Rosemary Lemurs because really led the charge and really took charge of that board for that year and really was well done.
But all the talented people that have come together, and this school district is a tremendous credit to this town. So, now, do you have any more, sir? Because we'll listen to you forever.
We have kept you so long. I appreciate you.
We're going to vote now?
Yeah.
Well, yes.
Let's vote.
On the bond proposal for the SAU 90 School District to renovate the Hampton Academy. Barbara, the figure again?
$25,950,000.
$25,950,000. In favor of recommending by the Budget Committee to the taxpayers. In favor? Okay. We have... thank you, David. Okay, so we have Ms. Barnes abstaining?
Yes.
And what are you doing, Michael?
No.
And what are you doing, Sonny?
Also.
And Sonny is abstaining, and Mr. Pierce is saying no. Okay.
Thank you.
Did you get that, Barbara? You all set? Okay. Then thank you so much, and thank you to the principals and the staff members of the school district and the other school board members. Thank you very much. Mr. LaBranch is moving to adjourn at what hour?
I would like to move to adjourn at 9. Let me see. 51. Seconded by Ginny.
Ginny. In favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much.
I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, there's no other budget with warrant articles.